Hey there, Mr. Reddit here. Welcome back to another episode of r/EntitledParentStories. Today we have a very special episode for you, a compilation of some of the greatest Entitled Parent stories we've read over the past year. So sit back, relax, and enjoy a few hours of the most entitled parents you've ever heard of. And by the way, Karen assured me that if this video gets 1,000 likes, she won't try to speak to anyone's manager for an entire week. So please smash that like button. And if you're new, subscribe and turn on notifications for new stories from Reddit every single day. And become an official member of the ReArmy today, and I'll give you a shout out in an upcoming video. r/EntitledParents. Entitled Stepmother. So my parents divorced when I was 9. It was amicable, and my parents remained friends. My mom even housed my dad after he went through a major breakup when his ex, after my mother, stole all his money and sold their house and refused to give him his half. Anyway, a few years on, when I was 16, he met Entitled Stepmom. She was 12 years younger than him and 12 years older than me. She never liked the idea that my dad had kids and always caused drama whenever my sister and I were visiting, so my dad didn't spend any time with us and we were left to entertain ourselves. Anyway, I'm now 27 and a single mom to a beautiful 8-month daughter. And my dad and Entitled Stepmom have 2 boys, aged 5 and 3, but I no longer see my dad regular because this happened. I went to my dad a few weeks before I gave birth, and I was a whale. I was having Braxton Hicks the whole time, which didn't help my hypermesis. I had been throwing up the whole pregnancy. I was not a pretty picture. It was only a day visit, and I said goodbye when I left. Then, when my daughter was born, my dad promised to come visit me every month because he knew how hard it was to raise a baby and wanted to help where he could. So because of my ex, an abusive jerk, I had to go to court to give evidence of what I had been through, and my dad had promised to cover the costs of a family lawyer for advice as I was struggling financially and had no idea what to expect in court. The police were the ones being the case against my ex, and I was just giving evidence. Anyway, I go to court and it went fine. The next weeks pass and I get a text from Entitled Stepmom stating, "How dare you expect £300 to cover legal costs against your ex? You should be ashamed of yourself. I warned you not to stay with him, but you're stupid and selfish. I expect you to pay every last bit of that money to us." I was shocked and just spoke to my dad about whether the money was a loan because I thought he promised to cover it. He said it wasn't and that Entitled Stepmom was just upset that I hadn't said goodbye to her and her precious boys when I visited last, the time I was heavily pregnant. I was dumbfounded. He told me to lie to her and say I paid it back while he moved money around to make it look like I paid him on their account statement. Then, after all of that, she started to get in the way of every time me and my dad made plans to meet up or she'd come along. The last time she came, she made sure they were late while I had organized a whole day for the boys to have fun at a farm near me, which closed at 3 p.m. They got to mine at 2 p.m. and then just said, "Well, we can teach him to ride his bike down the road." I just said, "Oh, okay. But I kinda wanted you guys to be able to spend time with my daughter, as you rarely see her. I can grab some board games and toys for them to play with, as we're not going to the farm now." Entitled Stepmom: "We bought his bike, and he wants to learn now." I just give in because my daughter, 6 months at the time, was climbing all over me, and I could see my dad didn't want conflict. My dad asks to hug my daughter, and I happily let him, and he has fun. Entitled Stepmom sits down next to him and instantly takes my daughter's dummy. She wanted to talk to her. My daughter, however, stares at her with death glares and instantly starts fighting to get her dummy back, all without making a sound. My daughter isn't too keen on my Entitled Stepmom, who never holds her or feeds her, so she's on the bottom of my daughter's favorite people list. When she refuses to give my daughter back her dummy, my daughter starts screaming. It was coming up to nap time, which is why she had her dummy in the first place. After making my daughter cry, she promptly pulls my dad outside for him to teach their son how to ride his bike. She then proceeds to tell me, "You must miss living near your mom." I do, but it's close to my ex, and I want my daughter and I to be as safe as possible, I replied. "Well, you'd get much more help if you lived near her," she retorted. That's probably true, but as you know, my sister lives nearby, and she helps where she can. "You can't rely on your sister. She is getting married to a lawyer." My brother-in-law, who I've known since I was 16, and they have been together for over 10 years. "And soon they'll have kids and won't be able to help you." But that's why I help them in return. I house sit and look after their cat when they ask, and I'm helping my sister with her wedding. It's the least I can do. "Well, I still think you should look into living near your mother." That's when it clicked. My mom lives 2 hours from me and 4 hours from where my dad lived. Entitled stepmom wanted me and my daughter, my dad's only grandchild, to move far away from them even if it was into danger, because she didn't want us nearby taking my dad's attention away from her and her sons. She has been like this since I was 16 and had gotten worse when I got away from my ex. So I just said, "I'm not moving. I'm happy where I am." She then huffed and decided it was time for them to leave. They had been at mine for a max of an hour, and I had barely spoken to my dad. I've just given up. She has her claws so deep into my dad, and I've just given up making an effort to organize days out with my dad and my brothers, because she always finds a way to shorten the day or cause drama to make me look like I'm being disrespectful. I don't want my daughter around her, so I've decided to keep my visits to them only for one day at Christmas, and if my dad wants to visit, I just ask if it can be just him, as I'd love just some one-on-one time with my dad, which I haven't had since he met her. Next we've got PSA. Student tour guides do not make admissions decisions. In college, I was a tour guide for prospective students. You know, walking backwards and telling scripted puns. Technically, I was employed by the admissions office to do this, but in no capacity was I involved in admissions decisions whatsoever. No one asked me, "Which kids asked a smart question?" or "Who texted through the whole tour?" or anything. My entire job description was show up, walk the families around campus, answer questions about student life. For context, I'd give 3 to 6 tours a week to groups of 40 plus people. So I was home for break one Christmas and in a large chain store when I see a woman glaring at me. I don't think much of it at the time because I didn't know her, but as I progressed down the aisles, I realized she was following me. She had a daughter about my age and they were whispering. All I was able to catch was, "No, that's definitely not her." The woman approaches me and says, "Are you?" my name. "Who toured us around my college?" And I say yes. "I bet you think you're pretty hot stuff, huh?" What? "My daughter had a rock solid application and her alumni interviewer said her chances were very good. 2 days after our visit, she's rejected. You're the only one affiliated with the university we spoke to that whole time." The daughter. "Yeah." "Quiet. I am handling this." "I'm sorry to hear she wasn't accepted, but I have nothing to do with admissions decisions. I just give tours." "I'm not an idiot. I know they tell you to say that." "No, seriously. I'm a sophomore there myself. You can call and ask. I do not get any input into admissions."
"But you work for the admissions department."
"Okay. Technically, they hired me, but like, there are janitors who work for the admission department, and they don't get to decide who gets in. It's a specialized job."
"Quit your bull."
Daughter.
"I had near perfect ACT scores. I bet I had better scores than you."
At this point, I think my mom thought I was just catching up with people I knew, since there was a girl my age, but she started to realize something was wrong at this point. Daughter.
"Just tell me why you didn't let me in. You can tell me. It's the past now. Just tell me."
"Was it a community service issue? Come on. Be honest. You can tell us. Me. I really don't know. I have nothing to do with it, I swear. You can actually call and ask, and they will tell you. Tour guides don't get to decide that stuff. You bet we will be calling and filing a complaint. And my mom. Excuse me, what's happening here? Who are you? Woman. Who are you? My mom. Is everything okay? I was getting upset by this point because a lot was going on. And if you insist loudly enough to me that I've done something wrong, eventually I'll start to believe you. Daughter.
Is it because I'm white?
I'm a POC. My mom.
What? What are you guys talking about?
Me. Let's just go. Let's check out. Woman.
Not admitting my daughter was the biggest mistake of your career. I'm a millionaire, and I would have made big donations to the school. When your boss hears from me, you're going to be fired.
I wasn't even upset at that point because it was so absurd. No way a millionaire would be shopping at the store we were in. My mom leads me away and looks at me, still very confused as to what's going on. We bought our items, and I was pretty rattled as I went to the car, but as I was explaining, the absurdity of the whole situation finally hit me, and I just started laughing. Next we've got Lady Goes Full On Karen. This story happened last week. I live in Scotland, and this took place at my local Tesco. For context, I don't work because I'm disabled, and I have to use a walking stick to get around. And on this day, I was wearing a green camouflage jacket, blue jeans, and a black bandana. The uniform for Tesco employees is black trousers and blue fleece with a name tag, not remotely similar. So I'm just trying to get a few things for dinner and walking around the chilled section, minding my own business. I then feel the talons of a Tyrannosaurus digging into the flesh of my arm, followed by the ear-piercing screech of,
"Excuse me?"
Our cast. We've got me, the ghost who walks. We've got Entitled Mom, Tyrannosaurus. And we've got the manager. So, I turn around to see the massive, overinflated beach ball with a bad bob cut snarling at me with a face that looks like it went through a deep fryer. Me. Can I help you? Karen.
About time you noticed me.
Believe me, I could smell her before I saw her.
I've been waiting for ages for you to help me.
I stand there, puzzled as to why she was saying this to me.
I can't find the
random items that I don't remember.
Where are they?
I don't know. I don't work here. But I think a staff member is in the next department.
Don't lie to me. You do work here. I've seen you here before. So you have to work here. I'm not stupid enough to fall for your BS.
At this point, I decided it was time to not be nice. I take off my glasses and hand them to her. Do you need to borrow these? She looks at me with a puzzled look.
What are you talking about?
I guessed that you must have bad eyesight and can't see that I'm not wearing a single thing that remotely resembles the staff uniform.
That doesn't mean anything. You could just be on your break, so you still have to help me.
She stands there with a smug look on her face, thinking that she just proved a point. Lady, did you sustain a major head injury recently? No, wait, I think I got it. Your parents were brother and sister, weren't they? Because that would explain your disturbing lack of intelligence. I then see something that I would never have believed possible. Karen turns from white to red and then to purple. She throws her head back and lets out the loudest and most ear-piercing scream I have ever heard. I thought she would stop after a split second, but no. She screamed for a solid 15 seconds without taking a breath. This was impressive, but what then followed was a scene from The Exorcist. She projectile vomited straight up like a water fountain made of mushroom soup and cheap vodka. When she was finally done, her eyes rolled into the back of her head and she dropped flat on her puke-covered face. I look around to see the whole store watching and the manager walking over to me.
Oops. Manager. What the heck happened here?
I try to explain what happened, but he didn't seem to get it and asked me to leave.
Ordinarily, I would have complained, but in this case, I just wanted to get the heck out of there. I was lucky he didn't call the police, and Karen was fine after a few minutes. I saw her get up as I was leaving. Next we've got,
I want it on my card.
Oh, wait. As a cashier, I process several refunds a day. I'll generally get some sketchy ones and some normal ones. There was one I processed fairly recently that was beyond sketchy. Let me explain something first though. The company I work for processes returns by scanning a barcode that comes printed on the bottom of every receipt. We scan the barcode, then the item, if it matches up with the receipt, and input the return price of said item. After the return is finished, you may purchase other items in exchange or get the negative amount back in whatever way you paid, except checks, that's another story. Now this is what's really confusing. If you return an item at a different store in exchange for another item at that same store, but you go to an entirely different store to return that exchanged item, you're stacking returns. The money coming back on that second return will go on a gift card instead of what you paid with in the first exchange. Why the registers do it this way, I'll never know. If you know, please enlighten me. Anyway, I had a guy give me a receipt from another store with a returned wheelchair at the top for $149.99. In exchange for this wheelchair, he bought a walker worth $129.99. Mind you, this exchange took place at an entirely different store. So he wanted to return the walker he just bought in an exchange. I said, okay, and processed it. As I mentioned earlier, whenever items are double stacked like this in a return, the difference will go back on a gift card. He went into a hissy fit, saying,
oh, my wife will be mad if I bring back a gift card. Can't you just give me cash, or just put the difference back on my debit card?
I sighed and told him, no sir, we can't. The way these transactions are set up, whenever returns are double stacked like this, the register forces us to put the difference back on a gift card regardless of what you used to pay before. He pulled the classic line,
let me speak to your manager.
I called a manager over and they were dumbfounded. They had never heard of stacked returns before and tried voiding the whole transaction. The manager processed the entire thing the same way I did and didn't understand why the register did what it did. This guy kept insisting we just put the difference back on his card. We kept saying no, and he was getting angrier and sweatier. As soon as the manager mentioned that he could use the gift card at any of our other branches, he went,
oh, I can? Cool, that works out then.
He then walks away with gift card in hand and acting satisfied.
I'm sorry.
What? A manager mentioned something that should probably be common knowledge based on how much he shops here. The only thing that can satisfy him is a manager's decision? I wanted to punch a wall after that encounter. Next we've got,
I cannot do that, sir. That would be a breach of privacy.
Obligatory info. I work as a department lead in a retail store that sells everything from home goods to apparel to groceries. We have a desk area on the sales floor that has a computer and a few other things there. The amount of people who think it's a register is kind of astounding, but that's not really the point of this story, even though that's how it began. I was standing at this computer with my scanner looking up stuff in our system to update out of stocks in my department when a man came up. Me.
Hello, can I help you with anything today?
Yes, I'd like to check out.
Oh, I'm sorry. This isn't a register, but there's one just over this way.
I indicate the direction of the nearest register.
Oh, okay. You know, my kid works here.
That's nice. It's a good job. I've been here for a while. Who is that? I might know them.
He says a name I don't know.
I don't know that person, but I'll keep an eye out for them and say hi if I see them.
You know, my kid lives with me. I can't remember their phone number for their card. Can you look it up?
He indicates the computer I'm at.
I'm sorry, I don't have access to other employees' phone numbers, and that isn't something we would be allowed to give to a customer, even if I did.
Why not? They're my kid.
I cannot confirm that in any way.
I have ID.
He starts to pull out his wallet. I'm sorry, but I still wouldn't be able to confirm that name is your kid. Are they working today? You could find them. And he interrupts me.
No, don't you think I would have done that already?
I'm sorry.
I want to talk to a manager.
I am the acting manager on shift today.
I want a real manager.
Yeah, he said it like that. The manager of my department is not in the store at the moment. I can call, he interrupts me.
You are not a manager.
Points at my name tag.
Your tag does not say manager. I want my kid's phone number, now!
I'm sorry, but I cannot do that, sir. It would be a breach of privacy. I can call, he interrupts me.
I'm their father! I want the number!
I just pulled out my phone and called another department's manager over while he was yelling this at me.
Don't ignore me! Get off the phone!
Me, into the phone. Hi, this is Queen Frankie 420 in my department. I have a customer over here at our location, and he's asking to speak to a manager. My manager is on lunch and not in the store right now. Could you possibly come over? He's screaming at me the entire time, and the other person says, "What in the world? I can hear him over here without the phone." I'll be right there. Me into the phone. Thanks. I tell the customer, "They're on their way over to talk to you."
Why don't you just do your job and give me the phone number?
I ignored the question. They will be here in a moment to address that issue. He kept yelling at me, and I repeated that line twice before the manager finally got there. I don't know exactly what happened after that, because they walked away together, and I stayed there to complete my job. Another one of my encounters of the species Charonpithecus entitled day. So this happened last week, and I thought people would enjoy reading this. I was at a Starbucks with my one-year-old son. We were waiting for my partner to finish work. This particular branch was located at a mall, so it was guaranteed to be crowded. So I end up having to sit down on the tables on the outside part of the place, which was near the walking area of the inside of the mall. My partner wouldn't arrive until an hour and a half, and I had time before we went out to dinner, so I ordered an iced coffee and a pastry while we waited. I sit my son down on his stroller and let him watch cartoon videos and go get my order. Near my table, there were these preachers, people who had these huge signs with religious subjects on them, and one of them had a microphone that they used to shout Bible verses at the people walking by, while the others are trying to hand out pamphlets to anybody that walks past them. I could easily hear the woman who was preaching, her voice amplified by her mic, and she was talking about the apocalypse and the rapture, and how people need to reject sin and accept God into their lives. I don't mind nut jobs like them, as I understand freedom of religion, but I don't like when they persist to preach to me after I tell them no. At first, I do my best to ignore them, and it seemed to work. I put on one earpiece of my earphones and watched some reruns of Game of Thrones. My son was still engrossed in his watching of Peppa Pig, although I already gave him his bottle, and he is sipping on it whilst watching. I was maybe about 20 minutes in the episode I was watching when I see from my peripheral that someone was walking towards me. Alas, peace wasn't destined to me by the old gods and new. I hear this boy ask me if I had a few minutes to talk to him. I know he's part of the preaching group because he was wearing similar clothes to them. They were wearing formal attire that made them stick out in the sea of mall goers who mostly wore casual, and he was carrying a stack of pamphlets. I tell him sorry, but I don't want to hear about his preaching, and if he can kindly leave me alone. He was insisting I listen, but I just tell him no, and proceed to ignore further conversation by plugging back in the earpiece I took out when I answered him at first, and go back to watching. He leaves me alone, and I happily go back to watching. That should have been where it ended, but I wouldn't be here if it was. I hear a woman speak at me, and when I turn, it's the preacher with the mic. She wasn't holding a mic anymore, and instead, another member of her group was holding it and was now preaching. I take off my earphones and ask her what she wants. This is how it went down. Original conversation happened in my local language, and I am translating. Our cast. We've got entitled Mom, Charonpithecus. We've got OP, me. And we've got Starbucks manager.
We've got older man, also a customer. We've got my dad. Entitled Mom.
Excuse me, miss.
Can I help you?
My son told me that you were rude to him.
Excuse me? I don't even know who your son is.
My son! The teenager talking to you earlier.
Oh, that. I wasn't rude, miss. I just told him I wasn't interested in what he had to say. He was insisting that I needed to hear what he had to say. And when I told him no a second time, and then he wouldn't budge, I ignored him.
That's not a way to treat people older than you. That's rude. My son is off to college, so he's older than you are, and you have to respect him.
Look, ma'am, I don't have to do anything for your son or you. If he is off to college, then that still doesn't make me younger than your son. I'm in my early 20s. I look younger than I actually am, and it doesn't help when I am only 5 feet in height.
What? You're lying. You don't look like you're in your early 20s. You look 15.
Well, it says in my passport, birth certificates, and other legal forms of identification that I am in my early 20s.
Then they must be forged. You're a teenager.
I was wearing a thin strap crop top and jeans at the time, but had worn a denim jacket to cover up since it was cold. I also should point out that I have a small tattoo on my right rib that was visible when I wear clothes like that. I simply took off my jacket to show her my ink to prove I was not 15. That was a mistake because it made it worse. See that? Pointing to my tattoo. No sane tattoo artist would tattoo a 15-year-old. Also, that is illegal and punishable by the law. Risking both their business and freedom isn't worth tattooing a kid for a fee. I'm not 15. Please leave me alone.
No, you're lying. Where are your parents? Shame on them for letting their daughter defile her own body with Satan's mark.
My tattoo was a face of a compass. Okay, lady, you're just crazy. It was funny at first, but now it's just annoying. Leave me alone.
Not until I get to talk to your parents. They let their own child live in sin. That is unacceptable.
Me being smart. Sure thing. They're in Texas right now. Although the time zones differ, you can try talking to them. I'm sure my dad would just love talking to a random crazy lady about how he is failing as a parent at 5 a.m. I pull out my phone and start to FaceTime my dad, and he actually picks up. Cue my dad drinking his usual drink of black coffee and answering my call. Dad.
Hey, OP. Didn't think you would call. What is it? Everything okay?
Me. Hey, Dad. Yeah, I know. There's this crazy lady that wants to talk to you about how you let me live a sinful life. She still thinks I'm 15, too. Hey, crazy lady. Here. I turn my phone towards her so my dad can see her. Say hi, crazy. Dad, to me.
Another one? This is why I told you to migrate someplace else. Less nut jobs.
To entitled Mom.
Look here, miss. My daughter is a wonderful woman. She has a big heart for people who are in need, intelligent, and generally a good person. She is also a good mother to her son, despite being a first-time mom. Sure, she has flaws, but she's human after all. Also, she's an atheist, so save your attempts to preach for another person who actually believes in God. Take my advice and focus on yourself and let other people be. My daughter is not 15. She's in her early 20s. Now leave her and me alone. OP, I have to get ready for work now. Talk to you soon.
Okay, Dad. I turn my phone towards my son, who was watching his cartoons on his stroller. To my son. Baby, say bye-bye to Grandpa. My son looks up and waves his arm and laughs at the phone. My dad laughs, says goodbye once more, and hangs up. Me. So, are we done here yet, lady? Entitled Mom huffs and goes inside the Starbucks. I play it off and get back to what I was doing before. Not 5 minutes later, and she comes back with a manager in tow. Manager.
Excuse me, ma'am, but this lady said you were being rude to her and that you called her crazy. Is that true?
Was I rude to her? Not really. I only asked her to leave me alone after she kept on bothering me. Did I call her crazy? Sure thing. After she wouldn't leave me alone when I asked her to a couple of times. She's not even a customer here. She's part of that group over there. I point towards the preaching group, and she and her son have both bothered me since I got here.
Is that true, entitled mom?
Well...
Other customer.
Excuse me, I've heard their entire exchange. This woman has been bothering that girl and won't leave her alone. I can vouch for OP.
Manager.
Ma'am, please leave before I call the mall security. You and your group are not even allowed to do that here. If you bother any one of my customers again, I'll make sure to report your group so you can be banned from the mall.
Entitled mom tries to say something, but just walks away. She and her group leave shortly. Manager.
I am so sorry for that, ma'am. Can I get you anything else?
No need. I'm just glad she is gone and that her stunt didn't bother my son.
I am really very sorry for that. I'll give you and your son both free iced teas right away for your trouble.
Manager leaves before I can stop him. He arrives a minute later and hands me two bottles of iced tea, and I thank him. I also thanked the older gentleman for his words. We actually had a good chat. He is a widower and often goes to coffee places because his wife used to love going on coffee dates once a week, and it serves as his reminder of her. My partner arrived 20 minutes later than I thought and told him the whole story. We laugh about it over our dinner. Next we've got, Karen wants my trolley. This happened on a Saturday afternoon and had a proper Karen in the wild. As usual, a bit of pretext. While I have a collection of vastly differing skills, my main occupation has me on construction sites. Sites are inherently dangerous places, and every few years, one finds oneself in a crumpled heap a few meters below where they were moments previously. Such an occasion occurred to me on Thursday due to an old ladder rung going for early retirement while I was resting my entire weight on it. Suffice to say, I gave myself a proper spannering, dislocating and hyperextending my shoulder, giving my opposite knee a good twist and a decent bruising to match my ego. Friday and the first half of Saturday was spent in a drug-induced haze with heat packs, hot baths, and enough cursing to make a sailor blush. Late Saturday, my shoulder was still entirely useless, but I was starting to get mobility back into my knee, enough that I felt able to head to the local Sheep Value store. This particular store has a very limited amount of parking at ground level, but a decent amount at rooftop, with two lifts down into the front of the store. Trolleys are often in short supply in the store, so I grabbed one up at rooftop where they're in plenty, both to make sure I had one and to act as a bit of support to my ailing knee and shoulder. Get into the lift. Hold the door.
Hold door.
For a lady hurrying to make it. Down we go. As the doors open, I let the lady go first due to my busted hobbling, and I've barely cleared the lift when a wild Karen grabs the front of my trolley and exclaims,
"About time! You people should do a better job restocking trolleys!"
Her condescending expression gathering a hint of confusion about the eyes, much like storm clouds gathering when I don't immediately let go of the trolley. Now, I'm not a small guy. I'm 105 kilograms and 6'2", heavily bearded. I'm wearing jeans, sneakers, and a pale blue t-shirt with a girl kneeling in prayer and text that says, "May they all burn in heck." Fairly distinctly removed from the staff uniform of green vest, light gray shirt, and dark gray trousers. I'm pretty easygoing, but being in pain and low on sleep means I've been getting out of the wrong side of bed two nights in a row, and I have no patience for Karen's crap.
"There are plenty up in the car park. Feel free to go fetch one."
Karen's eyes nearly bug out of her head, and she jerks on the trolley while inhaling sharply to feed me some line about her privilege, no doubt. But she doesn't get the chance because her jerk on the trolley had sent a jolt of pain straight up my arm and my knee was halfway giving out. This presented via a loud grunt from me, followed by an angry and not particularly quiet,
"Goodness sake, lady, take a look at me and tell me what part of what you see leads you to believe I work here."
She didn't immediately let go, but just stood there, mouth agape and slack, eyes trying to find something to make sense of what I just said. I still had one good arm and one good leg, Turns out, that was more than enough to push free of Karen's death grip and hobble off. Felt like saying more to her as I passed regarding her "you people" comment, but couldn't think of anything witty at the time. Saw her pointing me out to a staff member when I was checking out. I pointed to a staff member nearby and mouthed "staff" while nodding my head. Pointed to myself and mouthed "not staff" while shaking my head. Put my bags in my trolley and hobbled back to the lifts. Next we've got, "I don't work for this airport." So this happened recently while I was at JFK. Me and a few of my childhood friends have been planning on going on a 2-week trip to Europe for years. We hadn't actually gone, because until recently, most of them were in college and I was working full-time. I am actually a pilot, which was part of the problem. So this was our first big opportunity. I'll go ahead and set up the cast. We've got me, we've got security officer, we've got Karen, and I'll call her Mary, Karen's really embarrassed daughter. So at first, it was a fairly normal trip to the airport. For me, airports aren't stressful, as I generally have the run of the place, mostly due to my known crew badge with my picture and the airline I work for that lets me pass TSA with some ease and go to the pilot areas. So while my friends are waiting in line, I walk over to the side and show my badge to the TSA guy with the wand, and he begins scanning me. I actually get through without much issue and turn to wait for my friends. That's when I see Karen staring directly at me. We make eye contact and she waves me over. Now she is in the TSA line, not far enough along to take her shoes off. Now I can't walk up behind TSA and I didn't want to go back through TSA, so I shake my head, not wanting to call out to her. I can see her face getting red. Now I'll say, I don't look close to an employee. I'm wearing jeans and a t-shirt, quite literally a Lipton shirt. And aside from my badge and my travel bag, I look nothing like a pilot. And I'm only an FO. Seeing my non-compliance, she immediately starts to shout,
"What do you mean no? You can't say no to me."
At this point, the TSA officer who had wanded me over walks over to her, asking her to calm down. She just kept shouting,
"Don't you tell me to do anything. My son is a platinum flyer, and he got me my tickets. You need to do what I say."
While I stand there, confused, the TSA officer asks her to step out of line, and she pulls poor Mary along with her. Karen looked as if she had won a great victory and begins striking past the TSA officer towards me. The officer stops her, and she turns on him.
"Oh, so you're playing favorites now? You let some employee walk through like he owns the place and step on customers, but not a platinum flyer?"
The officer already fed up, and I can't blame him. But he waves me over with a sad expression as he explains, "Look, he's a crewman. He flies for one of our airlines. That's why he gets to go past." I held up my badge for her to see it. Karen, looking at me with her platinum hair fury.
"So, you do work here, and still trying to ignore me. I'll make sure you lose your job and your license for this."
Me, what the?
"I don't want to hear a word from you, if it's not the name of your supervisor."
"I don't work here. I fly here. Airline. And I am on vacation."
"You just admitted you work here, and yet you still ignored me."
Luckily for me, Mary was starting to get fed up with her mother and tried to cut in. Karen ignored her, yelling about her son and how he would get me fired and her privilege as a platinum flyer. At this point, I really hadn't gotten in much of a word, but I didn't really need to, because Mary finally got a word in on her mother's mindless rant. Mary,
"You need to stop. Mom, we're going to get in line quietly and wait our turn. Otherwise, I've had enough, and I will simply leave you behind."
This shut her up, and I took my opportunity to walk away as fast as I could. Next we've got,
"Can I get cash back?"
So, I am a customer service manager at a grocery chain store. I was getting ready to leave for the day, but still needed to help a cashier print something out. So, I was waiting for her at the service desk, located right outside the office we needed to be in. The cast in this story is me. We've got cashier 1, cashier 2, my fellow manager, we've got customer, and customer's friend. While I'm waiting for cashier 1 to come up to the office, customer walks up to the desk, holding a pack of sunflower seeds.
Can I get cash back?
Yes, you can get cash back.
Can I just get $10?
No, 20 is the minimum.
I can't just get 10?
No, it won't give you the option for less than 20. But I can break down the 20 for you.
So I couldn't get just 10?
I can do an unload on your card, but that has a $3.74 fee on it.
I'll just do the 20.
Okay. I log into the register and scan her sunflower seeds. Then her friend comes up to her with a gallon of milk. Did you want to purchase this too? Gestures to the milk. Customer and customer's friend continue talking. Me. Did you want to purchase the milk too?
Not right now.
Okay. That'll be 52 cents.
That's 60.
Hands me 60 cents. Me. Slightly confused. Cashes her out. 8 cents is your change.
Oh, I was gonna get cash back.
You have to use your card to get cash back.
Okay.
She walks away. By this point, my cashier had come up to the desk, so we go into the office to print out her papers. Then, cashier 2 calls me from the self-checkout. Hey, there's a customer out here that said she paid for her sunflower seeds at the desk. Me. Yes, she did. Okay. Cashier 2 hangs up, but then immediately calls me back. She said she's missing her cash back. Me. She has to use her card to get cash back. She paid cash, so she didn't get any. Cashier 2. Okay. I finish helping cashier 1 print her papers, so I come out of the office and walk up to the self-checkout podium where cashier 2 is standing with customer and customer service manager. CSM. Do you have a receipt? She said she doesn't have it. Yeah, I have it up there. I'll go get it. I walk back to the service desk and get her receipt out of the trash can. I turn and see that she had followed me, so I hand it to her. She then walks back to the self-checkout and speaks with CSM again. I walk back over because I can tell this isn't over. CSM. Can you give her a refund? She wants to refund it to buy it again for cash back. Me. Okay, but you have to use your card to get cash back. Customer.
Yeah, I was going to, but you just rang it up and did whatever you wanted.
And I'm just standing there. Like, you gave me money to pay for your item. What did you expect me to do with that? If you hand me money, I'm going to tell the register that you gave me money. But I just tell her that I can refund her at the service desk. So we go up to the desk and I give her the 52 cents back. She takes the money and starts walking away. Me. Do you want to ring it up for cash back? Customer with an attitude.
I'm going to do it over here at self-checkout.
I just thought to myself that the self-checkout is only going to give you a 20 back, and we won't be able to break that down for you. But okay. I immediately clocked out and came home to rant to my roommates about her. I just don't understand where her confusion came from and how she was going to blame me for cashing her out when she gave me money. I'm not your Uber. I was picking my girlfriend up at the airport. This was a few years ago. Uber was already big, but not as big as it is now. Our nearest airport is in a major city, so it's always hectic picking somebody up. The cops, yellow vest traffic guys, don't like you waiting around at all. So I got there, and it's taking my girlfriend a few minutes longer to get her checked bag than we anticipated. I'm on the phone with her, and she says, "I see it, I see it. I've gotta go, don't leave." So the traffic vest guy is waving at me, and I roll down my window and say, "I'm picking somebody up, she's just on her way," etc., trying to buy myself some time. I hear my trunk open, and I'm so relieved. She jumps in the back, and I thought it was a little weird, but she took a red eye, and I figured she was just going to lie down in the back and go to sleep. I say something along the lines of, "Oh, perfect timing. How was your flight?" And I couldn't hear her response. It was super loud with honking and cops shouting, so she closes the door, and I'm so focused on trying to find a spot to pull out, I don't even look back. I just say, "You good?" And she says, "Mm-hmm." And as I'm pulling out, I'm thinking, "Wait." And as I'm driving away, I look in the back,
and realize this woman is not my girlfriend. She's some teenager. I'm freaking out as I'm driving away and desperately looking for a spot to pull over. But by this point, I'm in the middle lane with rushing outflow of traffic, and when I finally saw a space, a cop or just a traffic director, I couldn't tell, very aggressively told me I couldn't stop there. While I'm trying to pull over, I'm like, "Who are you?" Her.
Molly.
Molly? I don't know you. What is this? What are you doing?
Were you expecting to know me?
I'm so confused at this point. My heart is racing, and it's all I can do to not crash my car because it's 4 a.m. and a strange kid got in my car at the airport. And my first thought was I was being framed for a crime or something. I didn't know what to think. Me. Why are you in my car? I'm pulling over.
Why are you pulling over?
Me. I don't know you. Her.
What?
Me.
What?
Her.
What is going on? Is this because it's a long trip? You can't cancel because of where I'm going. That's not allowed.
I take a few seconds to try and figure out what she's talking about while merging into a busy highway. Then it hits me. Me.
I am not your Uber.
Her.
What?
Me.
I'm pulling over.
You're lying.
Why would I lie about that? Look. Look at your app. Does the driver look like me?
Her. I don't know. It's blurry. You're driving a Toyota Camry. You are my Uber. Don't lie to me.
Me. There were a dozen Toyotas back there. How could you be so dumb that you'd get into a strange car without checking first? At this point, she starts crying, and I feel bad for snapping. Me. Look, I'm sorry. I just don't want to appear on the news or anything, and you really caught me by surprise, and I'm sorry, I should not have yelled. I'm going to circle back around to the airport. I have to pick my girlfriend up anyways, so I'll bring you back, and her.
No.
Me. No? Her.
No. Let me out. Let me out.
She starts grabbing at the door handle of the moving car. Thankfully, it locks automatically when I start driving. Me.
Oh my God. What are you doing?
Her.
I don't know you.
My worst nightmare coming true. Me. Hey, it's okay. It's a mistake. I'm not going to hurt you. I'm taking you back to the airport. She's crying again. Me.
This might be a bit of an overreaction, okay? It's fine. I'm not dangerous. I'm just clueless. Look, I'm going back to the airport. See? I'm taking the exit.
Her.
You knew.
Me. Knew what?
You knew you weren't my Uber.
Truly and totally my worst nightmare ever coming true in this moment.
No, I did not. I am taking you to the airport. See, terminal sign. We are 3 minutes away. Seriously.
Her.
Stop!
Me. I can't stop here. This is a highway.
There wasn't even a shoulder. Her. Crying.
Stop. Let me out. I don't believe you. Stop. I don't believe you.
I literally couldn't have stopped my car where we were without serious risk of causing a major accident. And it was not a safe place for a person to walk or even stand. So I was stuck. Her.
I'm calling 911 if you do not let me out.
Look, we are a minute from the airport. You can see the terminal. Look.
She continues sobbing. We get there. I park, and thank God she didn't call the cops. And I see my many missed calls and texts from my poor girlfriend. This girl bolts out of my car, screaming.
Help! Help!
Cops and guys in yellow vests, whatever they are, surround my car. I'm taken for questioning, and it takes so long that my car is almost towed. Thankfully, they allowed my girlfriend to park it. Thankfully, it created such a spectacle that my girlfriend was able to notice this happening and vouch for my being at the airport to pick her up and not pose as an Uber driver to pick someone up and park my car. By the end, the misunderstanding was completely sorted out, and the girl had calmed down, and she and her parents over the phone apologized and explained it was her first time traveling alone or being in a large city, and she was on edge. They never came right out and admitted fault,
but did say they wished there hadn't been such a misunderstanding. Now I can look back and laugh, but at the time, it was one of the scariest things I've ever experienced, and it was months until I could stop my car with the doors unlocked again. Next we've got, no, I won't land the plane in a field. Note, all names have been changed for privacy reasons. Small backstory. My dad was a pilot for about 20 years before retiring 8 years ago due to poor health. But in that time, my dad had many different jobs in aviation, so he could build up his flight hours and get better pay. That, and my dad doesn't like to stay in one job for too long if they refuse to let him come home and spend time with my brother and I growing up. He would often be in other states or other countries for days slash weeks at a time, so he had a lot of stories to tell. This is one of my favorites he told me, so I figured I should tell it here. Flying was his passion, but he had flown with a lot of entitled people through the years. Though, I'm going to give the entitled man in this story a name, since obviously my dad couldn't tell me his real name. Also, I'm sorry, I'm going to try my best to remember a few things. The story. This story happened when I was little, about 5 or 6, and my dad had been out of our state for about 2 weeks, flying a lot of important and powerful business people around the US. He was a charter pilot, so he was used to flying small private planes. He was exhausted from his intense flight schedule, but he is an extremely hard worker, so he made sure to power through into the third and final week. The job he had on this particular day was to take a man, who will be called Jason, from one state to a neighboring one, so Jason could go home. About a 4-hour flight that took them over the Rocky Mountains, but nothing too bad. To my dad, that was a very easy flight, so he was relieved that he could get some rest for the rest of the day. So as usual, my dad got up at the crack of dawn and headed over to the airport so he could prepare the plane. He already put in the flight plan a day or so in advance, and all he had to do was have the plane pulled out of the hangar and clean it up so it would be ready when Jason showed up. He always did this because he wanted to make sure his passengers were always stocked on snacks and drinks so they could enjoy their flight with him. It was about an hour before they were scheduled to take off, and Jason finally arrived with his assistant. Let's call her Nina. My dad is normally a patient man, but due to him having only about 3 or 4 hours to sleep every night for almost 3 weeks, he was standing in a silent rage while keeping the best professional appearance on his face. Jason was a very large man and didn't help my dad grab their bags and set in the plane. Nina was about to help my dad load their bags into the plane. He stopped her and said, "Nina, come on. Let the help do their job. We need to discuss the meeting." My dad was very angry with Jason, and even though this was their first time he had met him, my dad already wanted to kick this jerk off his plane. But still, my dad kept silent and loaded up the plane on his own. With only a few minutes to spare, my dad was cleared for takeoff, and soon he was flying out of the airport, beginning the 4-hour flight. It had only been about 1 or 2 hours into the flight, and the whole time, Dad was doing his job flying the plane with the door closed. He didn't want to hear them past his headset, since Jason was loud and obnoxiously talking about how much money he was worth, or how amazing his family was thanks to his money. What prompted him to close the door was this conversation. Nina.
Congratulations on striking the deal with the company, sir.
Jason.
Of course I struck the deal. If they didn't, they would be garbage and not worth the CEO's time or money.
Nina.
Speaking of money, you said your son will be going to college soon, right? Did you go with your wife's idea of letting him apply for scholarships?
Jason.
Heck no! My son is going to Harvard on my dime. I won't allow my son to be in debt like some middle-class common worker.
Edit. He really believed scholarships were the same as loans.
He has our family name, and anyone who cannot afford to go to an elite college like Harvard is better off being the help.
With Jason referring to middle class as the help, the same name he called him when they were leaving, my dad despised this man. So he closed the door and continued to fly.
Though his solitude was not long enough, as Jason opened the door to talk to my dad. So my dad kept his best poker face while staring straight at his console. Dad.
Yes, sir?
Jason.
Are we there yet? I need to use the bathroom.
Dad.
Not yet, sir. We still have about 2 hours to go. There is a bathroom on the back of the plane with a privacy door. You can use that.
Jason. His face wrinkles in disgust.
And use something that is like a common porta potty? I won't. Can't this plane go any faster?
Dad.
No, sir. I need to make sure we don't run out of fuel, and we will be crossing over the mountains shortly.
Jason.
This is ridiculous. Land this plane now. I know we are near another airport.
Dad. I'm afraid I can't do that, sir.
And why the heck not? I told you to land.
Finally, having enough of this man, Dad turns to look up into his eyes with pure anger. In truth, Dad could have tried to get permission to land from the closest tower, but he was not about to have someone like him have him risk his perfect flying record. So he hatches a sadistic plan in his head. Dad.
With all due respect, sir, no one tells me when to land my plane. Ever. And the last city before the mountains, we passed already.
Jason.
Ugh! Don't lie to me. Just land.
Dad. Unless you plan on peeing in the bushes or out in an open field, I suggest you use the bathroom in the back.
Jason. This is ridiculous. Just land.
Dad. I won't land until we get there.
So where am I supposed to use the bathroom?
Dad. Trying not to give an evil smile. I guess you're going to have to hold it. Now, sit down. With that, he closed and locked his door so Jason would have to leave him alone. Though before he did, he caught a glimpse of Nina, who looked frustrated and embarrassed. Dad figured she was used to him doing this before, and with someone throwing their power around, it wouldn't be long before he lost his own job. His phrase to me growing up was always, "Keep your head down, do your job, and do it well." Lazy or entitled people always shoot themselves in the foot eventually. Shine above the rest. The 2 hours finally passed, and as they landed at the airport, my dad began to carefully make his way towards the terminal. He had to go around a few of the taxiways to make it to the ramp, which is usually a slow process, though in this case, my dad made sure to go nice and slow, just to spite Jason. Soon, as they were approaching the ramp, Dad could feel the plane shake, and he opened his door to see what was happening. Nina was calling out to Jason, who had already managed to somehow finagle the hatch door open to the plane. Jason got out, and once he was on the pavement, he ran around the front of the plane and turbines and headed towards the terminal as fast as his massive body could carry him. As my dad tells me this story, he begins to laugh and tells me, Nina and the terminal reported him. Jason lost his job and got into major trouble with the FAA. But dang. In all my years of flying, I have never seen a fat boy run so fast. Questions asked or things said. 1. Did your dad lose his job because of this? No. My dad had to file a report about what happened to his boss, but his boss told him he was not in trouble. Dad was very professional in his field, but he also knew how to handle any passengers that posed a security risk. My dad did everything he was supposed to, and according to Dad, his boss was impressed at how he handled Jason. When Jason got out of the plane, my dad immediately hit the brakes since he was going very slow. So my dad made sure the dingus didn't get hurt. What happened to Nina? I'm not sure, but all I know is she reported what happened to the CEO they worked for, and the FAA found out what happened. Jason was fired, but Nina kept her job. That's all I know, since Dad never really talked specifics about regulations. 3. What happened to Jason with the FAA? All I know is he lost his job and got into a buttload of trouble. Next we've got, Entitled Mom and Her Daughter Proceed to Disturb Everyone. Cast. We've got Entitled Mom. We've got Entitled Girl. We've got me. We've got students 1 through 4. And the librarian. So a while back, I had loads of homework to do. So I went to the library with my friends, the students. There were a couple of quiet little kids, a bit older, louder kids, an entitled mom and entitled girl.
So we sit down, get out our books, and search for some books for our essay that we had to write. Entitled Mom spots us and whispered something to her daughter, Entitled Girl, who was sipping on her bubble tea, or some of you call it boba. A few moments later, we noticed the girl looking at our books and our homework. I looked at student one, and she also looks confused, very confused. So we go back to our seats with our books and start writing our essays. We had to write an essay and do a presentation over it, so I chose the theme animals that will soon go extinct. As soon as I started writing, Entitled Girl comes over again and closes the book just to see the cover. I was like, what the heck? So she looks at it, and a while later, this was the conversation. Me. Can I help you? Entitled Girl. No, I just want to look at this cover. She stared at it for like 10 minutes. Me. Can I continue writing now? It's important. Entitled Girl. No, I'm still looking at the cover. Me. This is important, so please let me continue. They have another book of this. Entitled Girl. Okay. She then just grabs it and goes back to her mom. I just assume it's her mom. Student 4. Just go grab the other one. Me. Okay, fine. I go grab the other book, and I still don't know why they have two of them, and continue my essay. A few minutes later, Entitled Girl goes to the shelves with the books on them, and Entitled Mom didn't notice. She sees me with the same book as her daughter's that she just stole from me and comes over. Entitled Mom.
Why do you have my daughter's book?
Me. Ma'am, this isn't your daughter's book. Entitled Mom, full alien screech.
That is my daughter's book. She just read it next to me.
Me. Ma'am, please don't yell at me, or I will call the librarian.
Are you threatening me?
Still screeching. While she screeched, everyone looked at her, even the loud kids. My friends were already screaming at her too. I was just thinking how dumb that lady is. The librarian came over because of Entitled Mom and told them to quiet down or she'll have to leave. Entitled Mom just sat back down and kept the book. So Entitled Girl came back from the shelves and asked me,
Why'd you lie that they have another book in the bag?
Me. I didn't. I took the other book because you took mine. I was about to laugh, but held it in because she looked angry. But after she saw that I did have the other book, she became a bit embarrassed and went away. Now she was sipping on her boba very loud. So of course, because they had enough problems with me, I asked student 3 to ask if she could quiet down, and she sipped even louder. There wasn't even anything in there. So after we finished our essays, while being disturbed by Entitled Girl and Entitled Mom, we put our books back, and I had quite problems to remember where the books were, so I looked for quite a bit. After I found the location, because the librarian came over and told me where it was, which was a bit embarrassing, I packed my stuff and noticed my sketchbook is gone. I sketch sometimes because of boredom. There wasn't much of it, but my aunt gave it to me, and I worked very long on drawings, and I immediately knew who it was. Of course, y'all also know who it was. It was Entitled Mom or Entitled Girl. Why do these two have to be such problem makers? So anyways, I already saw the sketchbook in her hands, so I went to grab it, and y'all already know what happened. Entitled Mom.
Blah, blah, blah. That's the sketchbook of my daughter.
Entitled Girl.
Blah, blah. That's mine, you jerk.
Me.
No, it's not. My name is on it.
Prove it, you jerk.
I show her my ID, and then they got kicked out by the librarian because she had enough of her. I also got the sketchbook back. We were already about to leave, and thank God we didn't see her. Next we've got, Entitled Mom wants me to rewrite her son's first ever LARP character because she thinks he deserves better. So let me give you a little background on how a pay-to-attend single-event LARP works. After we fill the spaces available, usually first come, first served, through the payment of a deposit, the ref team comes together and starts working on characters. We get the players to fill in a survey for us about their character preferences, anything we need to avoid, any personality traits they'd like to have, gender, whether they have an in-game relationship, etc. Some people give us lots of details, others are just happy to tell us what we should avoid. Now usually, we are familiar with a lot of the players participating, so we have an idea of what they play well, what they best suit, etc. You don't shove an incredibly shy person into a big, commanding leadership role unless they specifically request it. Down the line, the players then receive a good 6 to 8 character backstory written by a member of the ref team. I can't tell you how awesome it is to have them come up to you on release day and be like, "Holy crap, dude, I love my character." Anyway, the LARP in question for this story was this really cool, really tense weekend event focused around a group of freedom fighters in an unspecified Civil War type scenario. As the group planned a big attack, they had to deal with drama within the group, as well as a slowly intensifying assault from an unknown, unseen, supernatural enemy. To the ref team's surprise, one of the players who signed up was a freshman we shall call Entitled Moneybags Undergrad, or Emu. This event took place in the second semester, so Emu had been in the College Role-Playing Society, where 90% of our players came from, for a semester. He had never shown any interest in the LARP events run by the society, but he had been fairly active in the tabletop side of things. Anyway, Emu signs up in person, as most of the refs attended society meetings, and we were like, okay, cool, someone new. He didn't put much on his character survey, like barely anything if we're being honest, and his own, like, specific request was that he have a role where he had a lot to do. As I was the only writer who vaguely knew him, he played in one of the tabletop campaigns I was running for the society, I was assigned Emu as one of my characters to write. In short, Emu's character was the radio operator of the player party. It was a decently important role, and the radio started off as broken at the start of the event, meaning he would have to spend some time fixing it. I also knew from my tabletop game, and from speaking to the DMs of the other games he was in, that he had a tendency to be immature and mess around a little bit. And besides, this was his first LARP ever by his own account, so we didn't want to thrust him into anything too major. So in the end, I make this really cool character. He's a little cocky, a bit of a joker, but he respects the chain of command. I figured this would allow him to play the slightly immature character he seemed to prefer playing in tabletop games without it ruining the experience of others. Besides, everything we were using as inspiration, Alien, Assault on Precinct 13, etc., had that jokey character. It was just fitting for the genre of the game. So release day, about 2 months before the game, comes around, and the players I had been assigned, 4 of the 16, love their characters. Even Emu seemed happy enough. But that night, I get home from my bartending job to find an email. "Dear Mr. OP, I am led to believe that you are the one to speak to about this acting event my son is involved in. I would like to know as to why my son has been relegated to some superfluous minor role when he says he asked for the lead. Please rectify this immediately, or we shall be demanding a refund. Mrs. Emu's mother." In all my years of running games, I had never received anything like this. Sure, people had asked for minor tweaks to their character, usually because they felt they would struggle to tackle the role given to them, or they just wanted some small details changed. OP, I just want to butt in here and ask why you didn't just give the boy the main role. I've read enough entitled parent stories to know that that is not what you did. Hi there, preemptive comment section resident. I'm not sure how you got in here, but let me address your question while I have you. There are two reasons why this story will not see Emu take on a starring role in the LARP. Firstly, the leader of the Freedom Fighters was being played by a plant, someone we had placed in the player party without the knowledge of the other players, basically a deep cover NPC. This was because they were going to be the first to go to the mysterious entity attack on the Freedom Fighters, just to add a little more chaos. Secondly, Emu was a complete unknown. No one had seen him LARP, and by his own admission, he had never done this before. We tended to reserve leadership roles to known LARPers, just so the role wouldn't be undermined. It sucks, I know, but we have to consider the enjoyment level of 16 players, and most of the time, try to avoid a veteran player usurping the leadership tropes from an inexperienced player. Anywho, I reached out to Emu and asked if we could meet up for coffee that weekend to talk this over. He says okay, and a few days later, I meet him on campus. However, the dude shows up with his mom. Turns out she's visiting for the weekend,
and is at the meeting to make sure I don't bully her kid or whatever.
Me. Hi, Emu. So I'll get right to it. I just wanted to sit down with you and see what we can do to make your character better for you. I was sorry to hear that you didn't enjoy what I had written for you.
Emu.
No, it's just, I don't know, it seemed a little boring.
Emu's mom.
My son is such a talented actor. He deserves the lead.
Me, just straight up ignoring the mom.
What was boring about it?
Emu.
I don't know. I just don't want to be sat by a radio wall game while everyone else does cool stuff.
Me, completely understanding where he's coming from because I felt that way at my first LARP as a player.
Well, honestly, that's just who you are at the start of the game. Remember, this thing runs Friday to Sunday, and you know, it isn't just going to stick to the pitch we gave you. And besides, radio operator is going to be a really vital role in the scenario of the game. I get how you feel. I haven't loved some of the characters I've been given, but the thing you have to do is just play the role. Get involved. You're only going to be set by a radio all game if you choose to sit by a radio all game. Don't worry. There are going to be things for you to do in that role, and you will 100% be able to interact with the main story and all that.
Emu.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I guess I was being a little short-sighted.
Emu's mom.
Don't apologize to this bully, baby. You,
to me,
will not just sweet-talk your way into keeping my son in this awful role.
Emu.
Mom, it's fine.
Emu's mom.
No, I paid a lot of money for you to do this. And I will get my money's worth.
I start to try and explain about how we didn't want to overwhelm her son in his first ever LARP, how he didn't give us a lot of stuff to work with, and how, since everyone is paying the same, there is no inherent advantage to any one character. Of course, she cuts me off.
Emu's mom.
I don't want to hear it. Make my son the star, or we shall be demanding a refund.
Me.
One, I won't. And two, it's non-refundable, and your son knew that when he signed up.
Then I'll sue.
Emu.
Mom, please.
Emu's mom.
No, Emu. We're going. I'll see you in court, young man.
Me.
I look forward to hearing from your lawyers. Emu's mom drags her son out of the coffee shop, screeching about how she's going to sue, yada yada yada. At the next society meeting, Emu, or rather reformed entitled Moneybags undergrad, after I took the time to explain why he wasn't just going to be made a lead character in his first ever LARP, apologized for his mom and said that she probably wasn't going to sue. Apparently, she had just said that a lot because it got her free stuff now and then. I didn't get sued, and he went on to really enjoy the game. As I had said, the radio operator was a pretty vital role, and even he got to die a big hero's death as he sealed himself in a room with a traitor and some of the monsters that had been attacking the party. Mom thinks her kid should get the same discount she does. So, I'm now the owner of a landscaping business that my father started. He retired last year. He still checks in and helps a lot on the business end of things until I get my footing. We work in a city in South Florida, and about 95% of our customers are above the age of 60. My dad has 3 clients that we charge at a very low rate because they've used him since the start of the business. 2 out of the 3 are great. They understand that they're being charged a low rate and love us for it. But we have one lady that is very hard to deal with. My dad refuses to let go of her contract without a legitimate reason. That's just who my dad is. She has 2 daughters, and they both own homes with their husbands. We get a call from this lady asking us to take on her daughters. I told her if she would like to give them our number, I can talk with them and get it figured out. I was doing this as a favor to my dad, really, because adding the 2 extra properties right now stretches us pretty thin, and I'll probably have to help out as well as my cousin, who basically manages the crews. Anyone will tell you expanding with a landscaping company is not as easy as it seems, and it's bordering along the impossible without proper planning. So one of the 2 daughters calls in and gives me their details, and I told them I could come out and meet them and give them an estimate as soon as possible. That was met with a few seconds of silence and followed by, daughter.
My mom had told me about the rate she paid, and we were under the assumption that we'd be paying those same rates.
Me. Unfortunately, We won't be able to do that, ma'am. We give her a special discount for being with us for so long. Daughter.
She is my mom, and I'm sure she won't be happy to hear about this.
Me. Okie dokie. Her.
Click.
So I don't think anything of it. Tell my pops what happened. We had a laugh about it, and how entitled the people where we live are. Later that night, I get the call from the crazy lady. Me. Hello? Her.
Let me explain something to you. We have a way of doing things in this town, and you just broke rule one. The customer is always right. You told me you would take on my daughters, and I expect you to do just that.
Me. I told your daughters I could take them on, but not at the same rate. I never said I would be charging the same rate. Her.
Yes, you absolutely did. And I expect you to hold to your word like your father would. He would be so disappointed in you right now.
I'm guessing she didn't know my dad still took part in the business because he avoids her at all costs. Me. Okay, ma'am. I'll see what I can do. Her.
You better. This is just not how you do business.
Me. Okay. I went to my dad and told him about it. He told me to end her contract. I told him I had a better idea, and he agreed to it. Now, I say contract, but it's just a monthly billing for her contract, due to it being so low. So I call her back the next day. Her.
Hello?
Me. Hello there, miss. It's me, your landscaping company, calling you back. Her.
I hope you have some good news, because I still feel slighted.
Me. Oh, I have some news. We will be giving your daughters the same rate as you insisted. Her.
Perfect. When can I tell them you'll be over?
We'll get to that, but we have to discuss your new rates first.
What new rates? I didn't agree to new rates.
Oh, well, you're requested to pay the same amount as your daughters, so we've taken away the special discount we've given you, and your new rate will be $800 a month. That will start in 2 months from now. What came after was incoherent screaming and her hanging up. She called back the next day, but refused to talk with me. She tried talking with my cousin, but he referred her to me. She tried getting a hold of my dad, but he shut off his work cell long ago. She eventually calls back and tried to negotiate with me, but I told her it was all at her request and too late to go back on it. She dropped us the next month. She had been a thorn in my dad's side for so long. He was relieved when I told him about the call. He didn't want me to have the extra stress of dealing with her anyway. It's very easy and satisfying to tell someone to buzz off, but my dad lived by a set of business rules that his dad taught him. My mom saw Dexter and now refers to him as Dexter because of his fanatical obsession with these rules. Rule number one is very simple but huge. Don't ever give someone a reason to hate you. It'll serve to bolster your pride and can only hurt you in the future. And two, don't ever, for any reason, do anything to anyone, no matter what, no matter where, or who you are with, or where you're going, or where you've been, ever, for any reason whatsoever. Next we've got, it's a costume. No, really. My office had a Halloween-themed sales event today where everyone had to come in costume. Since I don't usually otherwise dress up for Halloween and didn't want to burn money on a single-use costume, I asked a mechanic friend if I could borrow one of his jumpsuits from work, and he obliged. This was good, both because it was a free costume and because it had a comedic element. Anyone who works with me knows I have a medical condition that disqualifies me from driving, so have never owned a car, let alone worried about car maintenance. So I was at the bus stop on the side of the road in my costume when a frantic lady runs up to me.
Sir, excuse me. My car broke down and I have no idea what's wrong. I'm headed into work and really can't wait for a tow. Would you mind taking a look?
Me. Oh, sorry. This is actually just a costume. Her.
Do I look like I was born yesterday?
No, really. I'm headed to a Halloween thing.
At 8 a.m. on a Monday?
Look, if you don't want to help me, be man enough to say so. Don't go making up a wild story.
Me. I can't help you. I don't even drive. I've never owned a car. I'd help if I could.
A mechanic who's never owned a car? Why are you jerking me around?
Me. I am not a mechanic. This is a costume.
I've got a baby in there. You're going to let my baby sit in a hot car because you're too lazy to take a quick peek under my hood?
Me. Thought you said you were going to work.
That's besides the point. Are you going to help me or no?
I can't. I'm not a mechanic.
I'm not stupid.
I didn't say you were stupid. I said I'm not a mechanic.
I'm going to call your boss and tell him all about this. You better believe I'm posting it on Yelp, too.
Me. You don't think it's the least bit strange that a car mechanic is here at a bus stop?
Turn around. Let me see where you work.
My buddy's company logo is on the back of the suit, and his name is embroidered on the front.
Me.
Whatever. Fine. Frantic lady dials and puts it on speaker.
You have 2 seconds to change your mind. You're about to get fired.
Doubt that. You don't know where I work. She sputters inaudibly. My buddy's boss picks up the phone.
Generic auto shop. How can I help?
Yes. My car is broken down on the side of the road, and your mechanic won't help me get it started.
Ma'am, are you sure you've got the right shop name? We don't offer roadside assistance.
Well, I didn't call for roadside assistance, but he's right here and refuses to help me.
Boss.
Ma'am, mechanics don't have to do anything outside of the shop or off the clock. You want a roadside assistance recommendation? Or...
You don't understand. He offered to take a look and took $20 from me and now isn't doing anything. He's just standing, refusing to help me.
First of all, bold-faced lie. I've rarely seen an adult lie so shamelessly and out of nowhere. Second, if I had just ripped her off for $20, why would I still be there? It wasn't even a well-conceived lie. Buddy's boss.
Oh, well, we can't have that. You're sure it was one of my guys? Did you catch his name tag?
It says Mike.
Boss calling to someone in the back.
Hey, did Mike leave?
My buddy, Mike.
Nah, boss. What's up? Listen, I don't know who this is, but don't you be prank calling this line again.
Buddy's boss hangs up, and I just smile dumbly at Frantic Lady.
Me.
Anything else I can help you with? Frantic Lady.
You're all just jerks. Thank God I went to college and will never be stuck in a job like this, and have morals, and wouldn't leave a lady stranded on the side of the road and play such a mean trick. And
she was still going as I got on the bus. I called the shop to explain once I got on the bus, and we all had a good laugh, and my friend said I should post on here. So, here I am. I don't usually use Reddit, so sorry for anything out of place or incorrect. Next we've got, entitled neighbor doesn't want palm tree to be cut down. Our family bought a house which was initially sharing yards with the house on our right. After some time, our family decided to build a wall between both properties, respecting plot boundaries and whatnot. Making the decision between building a wall or a fence was an easy decision. Our neighbor, entitled neighbor in this case, would snoop around and literally sit outside her house and just watch ours. See who came out, came in, visited, everything. That wasn't it either. Not only would she spy on who was going inside or outside the house, she would be a pain in the butt when it came to parking as well. When friends came over, she obviously would see them arrive and watch them enter my house. Creepy. After my friends came in, hanged out, and were planning to leave, they would encounter a little note on their windshield.
Next time you come over, please do not park here. This is a private parking area. Thank you.
Yes, they were parked in front of her house, but they parked correctly without blocking any entrances. Every time from that point on, they made sure they parked in front of their house, even though there was space in front of mine. Now to the palm tree part. When buying our house, the yard was shared, but in our half of the yard, there was this huge palm tree. We didn't mind it at first, since it made it easier for family and friends to locate our home. Just look for the palm tree. But after deciding to build a wall to avoid snooping from our entitled neighbor, we also decided to build a small apartment next to our home so that my parents can rent it and get some extra cash. After a couple of months of planning, we decided to build it in the corner of the plot, where the palm tree was. We made arrangements and called someone who would help us cut it down. The day came. This was a big deal, since the palm tree was very tall. About 5 to 6 workers arrived to our house and began talking to my dad about how things were going down. Note, the wall was mid-construction, just above eye level for me, and 1 or 2 feet above our entitled neighbor's height. After the workers came and parked in front of my house, entitled neighbor could still see who was parking. While we were talking about how we were going to cut the palm tree down, I see entitled neighbor with her hands above the wall and has her head above the wall now. I look at her and freaked out, say, me. Entitled neighbor, hello, did you lose something? Her, what are those people doing with saws? Me, her,
wait, you are not planning to cut the palm tree, are you?
The workers and my dad are now aware of her. Me, thought she was impressed or amazed, not angry. Actually, yeah, we are planning to build an apartment here. And
why?
We are going to rent it. And maybe before I could finish, she left and went inside. I thought this weird interaction was over. I wish it was. She returns and goes to the front of the house, fence door open, with her mother. Looks like she's in her 80s or 90s, in a wheelchair. Dad. Hi, what are you doing? Careful, there's saws and axes all over the place. Entitled neighbor.
You can't cut that palm tree. That palm tree my mother grew by herself, and it reminds me of her. At least wait until she passes away.
Yes, she's referring to her mom, not the palm tree. Dad. Sorry, but we are going to build an apartment, and it's on the way, so we will cut it down. If you want it, we could maybe move it instead of cutting it and put it on your side of the yard.
That would be great. You can put it over here.
Gestures to a location in her yard. I'll let you talk with nice worker then, so you can arrange the movement.
I'm not paying for it. It's on your property.
Okay then, since it's on my property, and I won't pay the extra fee of moving it, I'm going to cut it down.
How dare you do this, you piece of
me. I think it's best for you to leave, entitled neighbor, while I stand in the middle of them. She leaves and starts yelling from her side of the wall, yelling she'll call the police. I wish I could have a recording of the yell she emitted when they finally cut the palm tree down. Next we've got free trials. I work at the customer service desk at a warehouse store where a membership is required to shop. Everyone who opens a membership has to come to the desk, if only to pick up their store cards when they open the account online. If not, we process the new account in store. Every so often, corporate sends out offers for a free 3-month trial membership. These are part of a mass mailing list. I've worked there for 2 years and I get them occasionally. And the main goal is to get new customers in the door. Printed on every one of these mailers is new members only. Existing customers cannot open a trial, but the flyer also includes a promo code for a discounted renewal for existing customers, over half off. Our cast. We've got me, we've got Angry Guy, and we've got the manager on duty. Not in my department. The story. Last Saturday, I was working at the desk when an older gentleman came in. He threw the flyer down and asked me to open a trial. Angry Guy.
Hi, I'd like to use this free 3-month offer.
Me. Sure. Have you ever been a member with us before?
No.
Okay, I just need an ID and I can start processing the account right away. When people open memberships, their driver's license number is entered along with name, address, etc. Because of this, corporate asks that we check new members against the database to make sure they are not taking advantage of promotional offers like this. I enter his license number and an account shows up. No surprise there. People try to pull this all the time. Me. Unfortunately, there's already an account in your name. I won't be able to process the trial because that offer is only good for new customers. Most people realize they've been caught in a lie and I'll then offer to renew their old account for a discount. It's about half and half whether people do that or say never mind. Angry Guy was neither.
Well then, Why did I get this flyer? If I get this in the mail, I expect it to be honored.
Me, I do apologize, but I don't have a way to put this through without my computer blocking it. Not technically true, but I can get in trouble for overriding it. Also, when corporate secret shops the store, they check to make sure we aren't opening new accounts for existing customers.
Well then, I need to speak to the store manager, because until you get your act together and take me off the mailing list, I expect this to be honored.
Me. Sure, just a moment. I get on the radio and page the manager on duty to the front desk. Meanwhile, my coworker, who is with her own customer, looks over at me and, out of view of the customer, mouths, "What the heck?" While we wait for the manager, angry guy starts ranting to me about how he's never been a paid member and will never become one, which suggests he will continue to scream at employees until he gets his way. The manager on duty arrives about a minute later. He was on the opposite end of the store. Unfortunately for me, he's brand new to the store and isn't in my department. He's head of merchandising. My direct manager, who wouldn't have taken any of this, had left sick for the day. Manager on duty. What did you need? Angry guy goes on a rant, pretty much repeating everything he just said to me, but emphasizing that I won't allow him to open another trial. Manager on duty, not being familiar with our policies, tells me that it's fine to bypass it for the day. And angry guy's attitude changes like a light switch. He was so nice to me for the rest of the transaction that it was almost disturbing. For what it's worth, manager on duty did come back about 10 minutes later and apologize for making me put it through. I guess he realized how it made me look, and it hopefully won't happen again. Angry guy had left with his new card, but I wasn't done investigating. Searching by driver's license only turned up one account, but looking up his name revealed that he had opened 5 free trials over the last 3 years and at multiple locations. My guess is he screams enough until someone snaps and just does it for him. But thankfully, I left a very long note for the customer service manager, along with screenshots of every membership number he's ever had. His driver's license and name have been flagged in our database. Hopefully, the poor employee he screams at next time will see that and refuse the sale. Next we've got, don't argue with people you're paying to eat. So this happened last year on my third shift at my new job. I work at a pizza chain, Domino's, that's located just outside of a supermarket. I migrated to Australia about 6 years ago and had become an Australian citizen before I got the job. Mind you, I had a slight American accent, but I can easily switch to my Malaysian accent pretty quickly. We've got me as myself. We've got entitled Karen, and we've got my brother, the manager. My manager had sent me out of the store to go pick up some stuff at the local shop as we were running out of a few certain toppings. I sped walked down every aisle to search for the items, checking my phone because it was nearing till the end of my shift, whilst also glancing at cash out area. I finally found the items I'd been searching for when a wild Karen appeared. She started ranting at me about some stuff in another aisle. Note, my uniform is full black. Black dress pants, a black belt, black leather shoes, a hairnet, a black hat with a Domino's logo, and infamous black polo top with Domino's written on the back. It was clear to any sane customer that I was a Domino's worker, while as the workers at the local shop wore white blouse button-ups, black dress pants, hair tied back, and a badge showing that they worked at that local shop. To make it even more of a difference, I was still wearing the apron from Domino's. The hat I had to wear also had the logo on it. I remember the conversation going like this. Also note that this was during my first week at the job. Karen. What are you doing on your phone? Me. I switched to my Malaysian accent. Sorry, what?
So unprofessional. I have been trying to get your attention for the past 5 minutes.
Me. I don't work here.
Don't give me that BS. I want these following items. Make it quick.
She pushed her shopping list into my already full hands of large packets of oregano and chicken salt.
Me. Ma'am, I don't work here. I work at- Stop making the dumb excuses right now! Do your dang job!
At this point, I checked my phone and was well over overtime. While the wild Karen was busy ranting, I ran to the cash out and paid for the items. Then, as quick as my tired legs could, I ran back to the store I worked for. Gave the change and receipt to my manager, who's also my brother. Told him the whole situation on why I was taking 30 minutes to buy oregano and chicken salt. He said I can clock out now and take some spare garlic bread home. While I was in the midst of taking off my apron, the door opened. Mind you, our door didn't have a bell on top, but it did slam shut pretty loudly. Standing at the front was the entitled Karen from the shops. She looked fuming red. My brother handed me a couple of pizzas that were to be picked up. I yelled the name, no reply, so I placed it back on the hot shelf. I turned to entitled Karen and put on my most fake customer service smile and voice and spoke. "Hello, welcome to Domino's. How can I help you today?" In an American accent. Karen.
You?
Me. Yes, how can I help you today?
What are you doing behind there? You're supposed to be at the local shop, working there instead.
Then appears my brother, speaking in his fake customer service American accent. My brother.
Hello, ma'am. May I ask, why are you yelling at my fellow employee here?
She, give me my pizza.
My brother. May I get the name then?
A pepperoni pizza, now.
Me. Have you ordered your pizza? Karen.
What do you think I'm doing right now? Ordering, you idiot.
My brother. Ma'am, I must ask you to lower your voice and not to speak to our employees like that, please. I went on to make the order, but my brother had other plans. He told me to clock out and would pay for the overtime, even though it was a Sunday and we'd do 10% surcharges on Sundays. He came home later that night and told me that he had the security to physically remove her from the property, and now I haven't seen that Karen at all. And now, whenever I have a crappy day at work, and someone asks, how was work? I reply, oh sure, I enjoy feeding and making food for entitled ungrateful Karens and receiving shouts from drunkards for 9 hours a week. It was great. I really do enjoy working there though. Entitled mom gets angry at me for not knowing her language. I work as a cashier for a restaurant in Manhattan, New York, and it has its fair share of crazies. But it also has its handful of awesome people that I adore. I have met them all, from thieves to super generous tippers and kind patient grandmas that forgive my mistakes. I was not expecting this one customer to come in at all. Here's the story. We've got me. We've got entitled mom. We've got nice daughter and nice father. It was a slow day at work and there weren't a lot of customers. I took this time to restock everything from drinks in the fridge, plastic bags, and other basic restaurant equipment, both behind the register and in front. I finished up a lot of work, and I was in a good mood. I had a nice meal earlier that day, had some freebies from the other restaurants nearby, and was given my pay. Enter the family. This family of Chinese tourists came into the restaurant, and if you've lived in New York, you can just tell, even without the obvious hints like travel guides and maps. They came into the restaurant with their massive army of luggage and bags. There were six of them, entitled mom, her husband, her daughter, her son, and an elderly couple. The first offense they committed was the fact that they left their luggage and bags in front of the doors, literally blocking it like some makeshift barricade. This restaurant is small, so this was taking up a lot of space, but I couldn't let them block the door. Me. Excuse me, can you all move your luggage and bags away from the door, please? Entitled mom gives me this look as if I had just insulted her. She turns to her daughter and talks to her in Chinese, to which nice dad turned to me and said, I am so sorry about that. So nice dad proceeds to tell the rest to move their stuff. I have no clue what they're saying, but it was clear from the back and forth between the daughter and the mom that my request was an issue. Entitled mom tries to move the luggage back to where it was placed earlier, but entitled dad keeps pulling it back away from the door while explaining it to entitled mom. Nice daughter and nice father proceed to move their luggage while entitled mom just looks angry, shaking her head and occasionally pointing in my direction. Nice dad had enough of the argument and proceeded to walk towards me to look at the menu. Me. Good evening. Anything I can help you with? Nice dad. Hey, what's up? I'm just looking through the menu, and entitled mom moves to the front and gently pushes nice dad away from the register. Nice dad and entitled mom have another small argument while entitled mom pulls her purse out to get ready to order. All the while, nice dad was trying to study the menu and what we offered first. Entitled mom turns to me and points at the menu items while talking to me in Chinese. Mind you, I am a fairly pale Filipino. I have been mistaken for just about every Asian or Hispanic ethnicity. Why this woman assumed I was Chinese is a whole other unsolved mystery. I have no knowledge of Mandarin or any dialects of the Chinese language, so I had no clue what she was telling me or what exactly she was pointing at. Me. I am so sorry, ma'am, but I do not understand what you're saying. Entitled mom continues to speak in Chinese. Me. Again, I really am not sure what you're telling me. At this point, the entitled mom's disgusted look came back. She turns to nice daughter, expecting her to share the same shocked expression, but the daughter just shrugged. Entitled mom turns to me and says, in very broken but angry English,
"You speak to me in Chinese."
Me. I don't know any. Entitled mom.
Eh? You speak Chinese now. You speak to elder, to me properly. Not English. You understand?
Me. Ma'am, I'm sorry, but I don't speak any Chinese whatsoever.
No. You speak to me properly, or I will call manager. You understand? Speak properly, or you fired. Manager fire you.
I was not worried in the least about getting fired, but I was starting to get irritated at this woman berating me for not knowing her language. I was about to ask them to leave when nice daughter stepped up and started to argue with the mom. Entitled mom and nice daughter are arguing until the nice father got up and tried to intervene. Nice daughter and nice father tried to talk down entitled mom, but to no success. She was screaming, pointing at me and shaking her head. It gets to a point where the entitled mom walks away and takes her bag and is about to leave. It looked like she tried to get the rest to leave, but nice father and nice daughter didn't say another word to entitled mom and proceeded to look at the menu, clearly interested in what we had to offer. Nice father and nice daughter had that look of fascination and interest in the menu, and I was happy to help them out. Entitled mom is by the door holding her luggage, calling nice father and nice daughter, getting ready to leave. Nice daughter shakes her hand like she's shooing a fly out of her face, and nice father says something to entitled mom. Entitled mom continues to be irate at nice father and nice daughter. The elderly couple and the son are seated at the table, minding their own business, practically ignoring the commotion like it was a normal thing for them. While entitled mom tries to talk to the rest, clearly trying to get everyone to leave, nice daughter comes up to me. Nice daughter. Can I get the chicken plate? Me. Sure. Anything else? Drink? Extra toppings? Nice father. I get pork. Biggest you have, please. And, nice father turns to his son and the elderly couple. Maybe they were in-laws or his parents. I don't know. And ask what they want. Nice father. Make that 3 more porks, please. Nice father is about to pay for the meal himself when entitled mom comes up from behind, still yelling and still angry at nice father and nice daughter. But the two ignore her as they continue to order more food and drinks for their dinner. She gives me a death glare from behind the two, and she tries to wrestle any attention from nice father and nice daughter with no success. Nice daughter. I am so sorry about my mom. It's so embarrassing. I don't... Me. It's cool. I go through crazier moments than this. Nice father.
Crazy? How crazy?
Me. It's New York. There are a lot of weirdos here. While the kitchen prepares their meal, me, nice father, and nice daughter have a lovely conversation. Our talks are mostly miscellaneous topics like tourist spots, where to get desserts, and even about our own hometowns. Entitled mom is running out of steam, and every time she yells, nice daughter or nice father brush her off at this point. Fast forward to 40 minutes later, and after I cleared out their table, Nice Father gives me a hefty $10 tip, a thank you, and a smile. The elderly couple and son give their thanks for the meal and proceed to leave. Entitled Mom just has this sour look on her face while she struggles to get her luggage out the door. After the family leaves, Nice Daughter proceeds to apologize for her mother's behavior. She attributes Entitled Mom's attitude to the fact that she thinks she knows everything. Nice Daughter and Nice Father just wanted to eat, to try out something new without any complications. I told her that it wasn't a big deal and hoped that they would come again without Entitled Mom. Next we've got Cinderella and the Entitled Mom. I wanted to post this on Halloween, but I forgot I had a trip planned, so I'm typing this now. This happened when I was in kindergarten, and I remember it so well, mostly because everyone keeps talking about it around this time. Despite what you may think, I wasn't Cinderella, though I was one of the victims of the Entitled Mom in here. Cinderella, or Cindy as we'll call her, came home one day from school and told her mother how she and her three friends want to be princesses for Halloween. Any kind of princess, not necessarily Disney. Well, while the other mothers were either going to make the dresses or buy cheap dresses for their daughters, the Entitled Mom hired a tailor so he could make her an exact replica of Cinderella's ball dress. That included the accessories, including plastic shoes that almost looked like glass. I remember Cindy telling me that they had been the most uncomfortable shoes she had ever worn. Worse than heels, she told me. Cindy also had long, dark hair that her mother had cut, dyed, and styled to resemble Cinderella's hair. Cindy hated it. She loved her dark hair and hated the style of it. Still, she got to be a princess like her friends, so it didn't bother her. Of course, her mother couldn't stop bragging about how much it cost. Just a hair over $1,000, which was just ridiculous for a kid's Halloween costume that she would only wear once. Alright, so the schools in my area do this Halloween parade, where the students would form a line and weave in and out of the other classrooms, the line getting longer as each class joins, and eventually the students would take a lap or two outside the school. It's mostly for the parents, so they can see all of them and take pictures. The local news team is there, recording the parades, and they edit the footage for the news later in the evening, so only the cutest slash coolest costumes could be seen. For my school, though, it was all about looks and how the entitled principal wants it to look. The entitled principal. My God. I could write pages and pages of all the crap she pulled when I went to her school. But let's keep this focused on the Halloween bit. See, the entitled principal likes to keep the entitled parents happy by doing what they want, because they can fund the school and make her look good, or both. Reason I bring her up was because the entitled mom came to her on Halloween before the parade. See, entitled mom saw the other kids and thought that her daughter would be overshadowed by them. So she has the gall to ask the entitled principal to remove all the other kids who were princesses, and the entitled principal did so. Whenever anyone had an inappropriate or no costume, they weren't allowed into the parade and taken to the library. So Cindy's friends and myself were taken to the library and missed out on the parade. I wasn't a princess. I was dressed up to go to a dance, but I looked like a princess, I guess. By the time the parents of Cindy's friends and my parents found out we weren't there, the parade was in full swing, and they were not allowed to approach entitled principal because of the security guards there. But, oh boy, did they all storm into the entitled principal's office and demand to know why their kids weren't in there. She just stated that our costumes were not appropriate enough for the parade. All the yelling and threats fell flat because there was nothing they could do. Entitled Mom nearly cost her daughter's friendship with her friends. However, when the news came on that night, Entitled Mom was flat out furious when she discovered that her daughter wasn't seen in the parade. Remember, she paid $1,000 so her daughter could be the focus of the parade. Turns out, Cindy was in no way like her mother. She was angry at her for having her friends taken out of the parade. So, to get her back, she didn't smile. She frowned. And I'm not talking about a little pout. I mean, this was the ugliest frown that anybody could pull off. Every time a camera was pointed in her direction, she would give that ugly frown. Any kind of cute her dress showed was squished by that look on her face. She was not cute enough to be on TV, so her mother wasted all that money. Well, entitled mom wanted to try again the following year. However, during a yard sale that summer, Cindy and her father accidentally sold the costume and accessories for $5. Cindy made up with her friends, and they all still remained friends to this day. And the story still makes the rounds this time of year. Next we've got Mom Ruins Daughter's Birthday. A little background. My mom's dad passed away a couple of years ago, and my mom has been very upset. She cries every once in a while when she remembers him. When he passed, my grandma, my mom's mom, and my uncle, my mom's brother, just started being mean to her for no reason. For instance, my grandma told my mom she hated her and always did, but then later saying she was just being mean at the time, but she still never apologized for it. I have kind of moved on and try to stay away from my grandma and uncle, but my mom still tries to spend time with her mom because she believes it's what's right. But she hates her brother, so no contact there. Anyways, I'll shorten the names from now on. We've got Mean Grandma, we've got Grandma's sister, my mom's aunt, we've got my mom, my dad, and me, the best person ever. So there are many stories of Mean Grandma being mean to my mom, but my mom tries to keep me out of it to protect me. This one story was happening in front of me, so I know what happened. It was my mom's birthday, and she just wanted to spend it alone. This was because her dad loved to celebrate her birthday, so the day reminded her of him, which made her sad. I had made a little necklace for her, and a letter saying thank you for being my mom. She opened it first thing that morning. She said she loved it. I knew she would want to stay home, so I was planning on watching TV, playing board games, and other fun things with her. But then comes knocking on the door. It's Mean Grandma and Grandma's sister. My dad and my mom go downstairs to answer the door. We knew it was them by looking through the window. When they answered the door, Mean Grandma and Grandma's sister immediately asked where we are going to eat. Mean Grandma likes to take anyone out to eat on their birthday, and my mom hates going out to eat. She also has a genetic disease that hurts her sometimes, and now was one of those times. My mom tries to tell her that she hates going out to eat, and that she was in pain, so the smell of grease would cause pain. But Mean Grandma wasn't having any of it. I hear them and wanted to help my mom out of a bad situation, so I went downstairs. The following conversation, with a few mistakes, occurs. Mean Grandma.
Why do you want to go eat?
My mom. I really don't feel like going today. Mean Grandma.
Oh, come on. You can't stay at home all day and cry. You have to get out and have fun.
I come downstairs. Mean Grandma.
Oh, hey, sweetie.
Grandma's sister.
Hi, OP.
Me. Hello, Mean Grandma.
You need to help me talk your mom into going out to eat.
Me, knowing what my mom would want. She doesn't want to go. Mean Grandma.
Oh, come on. She should go and have fun.
Me. She can have fun here.
Well, she should go out. Where does she want to go eat?
Me. Here. I made a gesture saying the house we were standing in, which was ours.
Really? Oh, come on. Just go.
She doesn't want to.
Well, since you seem to know what she wants, what does she want?
To stay home. Mean Grandma looks a little mad. I said fully into the room where everyone is standing / sitting and make small talk with Grandma's sister. She also thinks that my mom should go out. We talk for a bit about old friends and hobbies. Then my mom says she is okay and I could go upstairs. Of course I do. And my mom, my dad, Grandma's sister, and Mean Grandma go on the back porch to talk. I really just wanted them to leave so I could spend the day with my mom. They were there for 2 hours trying to convince my mom to go eat. After a while, they call me to the back porch. I go, and they are still talking about random stuff. When my brother and I arrive, Mean Grandma asks us where we want to go. My brother doesn't realize our mom didn't want to go anywhere yet, and says everywhere he would like to go. He likes going out to eat. Mean Grandma looks at me and asks the same question. I just point to our house. She seems pretty annoyed. I went to sit on an old swing set we had, just so I didn't have to talk to them. After a while, I go back inside and stay downstairs on my phone to see what happens when they stop talking. My mom and grandma's sister come inside. Grandma's sister.
She really wants you to go.
My mom. I really don't want to go.
But she just wants to spend the day with you.
My mom. I hate going out to eat. It even makes me sick.
Okay, fine.
Mean grandma walks in the door.
Have we decided where we're going to eat yet?
Grandma's sister.
She doesn't want to go.
Mean grandma.
Fine. Let's go home.
She said it like we were disappointing her. They leave, but mean grandma left her iPad. We try calling her, but no answer. A little while later, grandma's sister comes back for the iPad. When she arrives, she comes in, without knocking, and picks it up. My dad and I go downstairs. Grandma's sister said mean grandma is sitting in the car crying. Grandma's sister leaves, and my dad tells my mom. My mom feels bad and calls them and says we're going. I literally just sit on the couch staring at the ceiling for the 30 minutes it took her to get ready. I try telling her that we didn't have to go, but she is too kind and is going to make mean grandma happy. When we arrive at the restaurant, my mom feels sick from just the smell of food. She sits us down at the table, but quickly walks out so she doesn't throw up. I sit down and talk with my cousins. One of them is 4 and asks me why Mimi, that's what she calls my mom, left. I just said that Mimi felt sick. After everyone finished eating, my mom and dad didn't eat. We just left. Mean grandma said nothing to my mom. No talking at all. Except before we left, she said happy birthday. When we got home, it was 9 o'clock at night. So mean grandma and grandma's sister just wasted my mom's whole day with the dinner and the begging. My mom said she only liked that morning when she opened my gift. Next we've got, I don't want it to ruin my reputation. I work at the customer service desk at my store. We take care of many things, including rain checks and answering the phone. Last Sunday, I got a call that went like this. Me. Service desk, this is OP. How can I help you? Guy. I got a letter in the mail telling me the item I got a rain check on is in. Me. Well, that means you need to come pick it up. The guy doesn't say anything, and I'm confused because we don't send out letters for rain checks. I stand there for a while, waiting for him to respond, but he doesn't. So I assumed he tried to hang up and it didn't work or something. So after a minute or so, I just hang up. A few minutes later, the phone rings and I see it's the same guy. Me. Service desk, this is OP. How can I help you? Guy.
We were talking a few minutes ago. Something must have gone wrong when you tried to transfer me.
I'm thinking, I never said anything about transferring you. Where did that idea come from? Me.
Okay, what did you need?
He tells me the same thing and says what the item is, and I tell him what I told him the first time. Guy.
But I already picked it up. It's sitting right here next to me on the couch.
That just made things seem more weird, because it is an 8-foot-tall blow-up Halloween skeleton. Like, why is that chilling with you on your couch? But it's whatever. Me.
Well, if you already have it, then you can just disregard the letter.
Guy.
But the letter came to my house today. I don't want my reputation ruined because I didn't come pick up the item.
Dude, the item isn't here. Even if it was, no one's going to care if you don't pick it up. It'll just go back on the sales floor after your 10 days to get it are up. And there's no reputation that'll be ruined. I didn't know what made him think that it's a thing. Me.
What's the date on the letter?
Guy.
September 21st.
And what day did you get your item?
Last Wednesday, October 2nd.
That means your letter was sent out before you got the item.
But the letter just came yesterday.
At this point, I'm just frustrated. It's a Sunday, so it's obviously from a previous day, when mail is actually delivered. I spend another 5 minutes explaining this over and over to the guy until he gets it. After he finally understands, he says this.
Well, okay then. I'll let you get back to watching the football game.
Me, very confused. I'm at work. The guy then proceeds to tell me about the game for another 3 minutes. I had customers waiting. I don't even like football. And it took him that long to tell me that the score was 0-0. Overall, it sucked. Next we've got Miniature Karen. I work at a grocery store, but I am not a member of the grocery store staff. I promote and sell the company MasterCard. I have my own little section of the store, and the only time I leave is my break or home time. I will also mention I look completely different from the regular staff. I wear a black collared shirt with the logo and black slacks. The regular employees wear gray t-shirts and jeans. They also have name badges. I do not. I had managed to stop a middle-aged lady and we were discussing the MasterCard. I do get a commission, so I was focused entirely on getting the app. Suddenly, a girl appeared next to the lady. She was maybe 10 to 12. I assumed the two people were together, so I smiled at her, then kept talking to the middle-aged lady. I had a brief thought that it was weird the girl wasn't in school, but figured it's not my business. Then,
"Excuse me."
I looked at the girl. "Yes, just one moment, please."
"I have been trying to get your attention for like 5 minutes already."
Now I'm confused. "I apologize. I didn't realize you had been trying to get my attention. I am helping this lady right now, but I can try to help you in a minute." By now, it was obvious the middle-aged lady had no idea who this kid was. I doubted I could actually help the kid in any way, as she was too young for a MasterCard, but I need to close this sale.
"No, I need your help now."
I tried not to look annoyed, and the actual customer checks her watch. "Quickly then, how can I help you?" Mostly, I just wanted her to leave. I was secretly hoping she just needed to know where the washroom was, which I get asked a lot. Alas, it was not.
"There's no more fruit in the bucket, and we need more."
At the grocery store in the produce section, there's a bucket with individual pieces of fruit that are free to kids. It's supposed to be for the younger ones who get hungry when their parents are shopping, but no one monitors it. "I don't work for produce. You will need to find someone in that section. But if the fruit is gone, it won't be replaced until tomorrow." Simultaneously, the lady starts making excuses to leave, and the girl starts throwing a fit. I completely ignore the kid and try to reassure the lady the application is really quick and easy. Nope, she leaves. Great. Now I've lost a commission because of this little snot, and she is now making a scene. I asked her where her parent or guardian is. Then she tells me her whole class is there on a field trip, and the other kids ate all the fruit, so I need to go get more. Seriously? I know sometimes exceptions are made to replace the fruit, like on busy days, or if they have extra fruit that needs to be eaten before it goes off, but that is not my department and not my decision. I am in the middle of telling her I do not work in that department when a man approaches. This is her teacher. I explained that I do not work in the produce section and I cannot replace the fruit, and he agrees quickly enough and takes her away. Not even 10 minutes later, I see the store manager walk by in a hurry. I heard from a cashier that the kids started just eating the regular produce when the free produce didn't get replaced. The teacher didn't get kicked out, but I'm sure he was told to keep a closer eye on the kids. I also later saw a bunch of kids running between the aisles, so who knows. As they left, the miniature Karen gave me a nasty look. I smiled and waved. Entitled Mother Tricks Me at Disneyland. I'm new here. This is my first Reddit post, so sorry if it sucks. Happened about 10 years ago, so details and dialogue aren't perfect. Possibly isn't extreme enough to be here, but it crushed my little 7-year-old heart at the time and ruined my day at Disneyland. So, oh well. Yep, on mobile. Sorry. Backstory. This happened around the time that Nerf, you know, the toy company, was just getting super popular, and to me and my friends, anything Nerf was super, super awesome. Yes, this information is important. So I'm Aussie, and my family decided to go on our first overseas trip when I was 7. USA was the first country that we visited, and of course, we decided to go to Disneyland. It was here, at one of the parades, that I had my first encounter with the entitled parent species, our cast. We've got entitled Mom, the master manipulator. We've got entitled Brad. We've got me, I was 7 at the time. And we've got Mum, wonderful, but easily tricked. Story. So on our second or third day at Disney, we decided to watch one of the parades that run down the main road. It was awesome. There were floats with all the coolest Disney characters, crazy mechanical floats, songs, dance, and everything, especially Disney. My little brain was amazed, but it was at the end that it got truly epic for me. Why do you ask? Free stuff. But not just any free stuff. Nerf! My little brain exploded. One of the final floats that went by must have been sponsored by Nerf, as they were tossing out bucket loads of these little Nerf-branded balls. I was super hyped, because they were something I had never seen Nerf sell. Slightly smaller than a handball, and a weird mix between a handball and a stress ball. Super weird, but epic. If I took one home, I would be the coolest friend in my group. Now, when I say bucket loads, I mean thousands. Enough for every kid and adult there to get one, and for many to get multiple. Being raised to be respectful, my sister and I each picked up just one and were super happy and content. The parade ended, the security moved out of the way, and all the other kids rushed to get the balls further on the road while we prepared to get up and go. This is where we meet, entitled Mom. As we are about to leave, I notice a mean-looking lady charging towards my family, dragging a girl about my age behind her. The girl had a ball in her hand, but looked sulky for some reason. Entitled Mom said something, and Entitled Brat put the ball away. Entitled Mom comes to face my mom, and in her most Karen voice, demands,
"Your son took my daughter's ball. Make him give it back."
Mom looked very shocked at this. "Mom, did you take it?" Me, being young, I was very confused, because I fairly picked my ball up off the ground and saw these people charge from the complete other side of the road. I tried to explain this, but was cut off instantly. Entitled Mom,
"He's just lying because he wants it. Make him give it back now."
I made another attempt to explain that it was mine and that this girl already had one, but this time was cut off by my mom. "Mom, just give it back, please." Me, "But, Mom, now." I had no other choice. I at least hoped that I would have the chance to pick up another one instead, but by this time, all of them had already been snatched up. I was destroyed. I handed the ball to Mom, who gave it to Entitled Mom. Instantly, Entitled Mom and Entitled Brad did that evil smile, glare that says, "Haha, forget you." Then they rushed off as fast as possible. I later got the chance to actually speak and tell Mom what happened, and once hearing my side of the story, she knew I had been telling the truth and felt terrible that she believed a random lady over her own son. So that's my story. Wow, poor you. You got a ball stolen. Yeah, I know. Not that bad. But at the time, I loved Nerf and was devastated. It was also the first time meeting an entitled person, so I was a bit thrown back and was sad my mother hadn't trusted me. Also, the dialogue was way more intense than that, but I was 7, so I can't really remember exactly what was said, but that was the simple basis of it. I'm sure if you want, you can imagine your own more intense version. Next we've got, entitled stepmother yells at my sister after she gets in an accident. In December of 2017, my sister was in a major accident. As I had moved out at this point, and I went to bed early the night it had happened, I didn't find out about it until the next morning when I saw the text my father sent me. As my mother abandoned us when I was very young, when I saw the text, my mother instincts kicked in as I had been very protective over my sister because of what we had been through together. My dad was at work, so I wasn't getting any information from everyone, but I had assumed the worst in this situation until my sister had called me around noon after she woke up and gave me the details. We lived in a very backwoods area, and many of the roads, while paved, are full of many sharp curves. I had talked to her earlier in the day before the accident, and she had told me that she was going to her then-boyfriend's church to watch a play. On our way there, she had taken a curve too sharp, ended up overcorrecting, and going down a hill in her truck. The hill led through a cow pasture, going quickly towards a ravine before slamming the front passenger side into a tree. If she hadn't have been wearing her seatbelt, she would have went through the windshield. If she hadn't have hit the tree, the truck would have flipped when it hit the creek and went down the ravine. She somehow managed to get out of the truck, while very much in shock, and walked all the way up the hill to the last house she passed. She told the older couple that lived there that she was in an accident, and they set her down and helped her call the appropriate people. They took care of her before my father, the police, and her boyfriend showed up, and I'm forever grateful that someone was there for her to reach out to. She denied medical care from the ambulance and had to sign a waiver, but she was lucky in the fact she was only scratched up. The worst injury was the back of her hand that has a deep V-shaped scar, which we assume was her hand possibly caught in the side of the ashtray. It was an early 90s vehicle during the impact. So when she finally gets home, she's exhausted, still in shock, and she sits down on the bed hoping that my aunt would come back over soon with some rubbing alcohol so they can clean up her minor injuries. My stepmom comes into her room and doesn't even ask if she's okay. She just starts tearing into my sister about her crashing the vehicle and how they didn't have money to buy another car for her and how it was going to raise the insurance and on and on and on. Everything becomes a money issue with my stepmother, despite her being the one putting my father into debt with her endless shopping sprees. My sister, being overwhelmed, just got up, said some sort of remark to my stepmother. Her memory is fuzzy, but we think it was a forget you of sorts, and ran across the street to my aunt's house to hide. She told me she started crying to our aunt, and my aunt, who is a very mild-tempered lady who always tells us to show people kindness, about wanting to rip my stepmother's head off. My father came over there after a while to retrieve my sister, and my stepmother was fuming and she almost didn't want to leave. My sister reluctantly went back over to the house, and when my sister told me this part, I almost got in my car to drive up there and tear into my stepmother myself. When she walked back into the door, my stepmother looked at her and said,
"I demand an apology for what you said to me."
My sister, who had just been in a serious accident, is expected to give my stepmother an apology for a fight my stepmother picked? My sister, who was in extreme shock from the events, was being treated as if this was just a little fender bender, that's something not to cry about, rather than the accident being as serious as it was. My sister wanted to get my stepmother off her back, gave her a weak apology, and when that wasn't enough, she was forced to give another one. Days after this, my stepmother continued to rant and rave about the truck and the insurance and not how my sister was lucky to be alive with us still. My father worked out with my aunt that she would sell him one of her vehicles for my sister to drive, and she's had that one since. Oh, and just to add, when my stepbrother basically totaled his truck, hitting a deer a couple months ago, my stepmother made a scene sobbing and crying, saying he was lucky to be alive, even though the truck took the majority of the impact. She talked his father into spending more money than that truck was worth to get it completely repaired. No wonder he's also entitled like his mother. Next we've got, crazy lady tries to take an Xbox before the store opens. I work as a warehouse stock person in an electronics store. Basically, I go around to every shelf in the department and make sure the products are in the place they should be. It's a pretty easy gig, especially since I clock in and clock out before the store opens, so I never interact with customers. Until today. It was a pretty typical morning of checking off the shelved products when I heard someone loudly banging on the locked front doors. I could hear it all the way from the back of the store where I was wrapping a security tag onto an Xbox One X, important for later. While carrying the Xbox, I walk into view of the doors and see a 30-something-year-old woman banging her fist on the glass. I saw that she was wearing a jacket with the company color on it, so I assumed she was a coworker. She stopped banging when she saw me and waved hello. Remember, I only work the before opening shifts, so I never interact with customers. But I also don't know all of my other coworkers who do work during store hours. I thought to myself, oh, she must be one of the sales reps, because they often come in 30 minutes early if they have an opening shift, and it was around 40 minutes until opening, so it didn't raise any alarm with me. I walk up to the front doors. There are two sets of them with a vestibule in between them. The first set opens to the outside and lets you into the vestibule. The second set opens to the vestibule and lets you into the store. The lady is standing outside. I take the Xbox I was holding and place it on a register counter nearest the doors. I unlock the second set of doors and step up to the first set and begin pushing it open when the lady shoves her body through the opening of the doors. I guess waiting 2 whole seconds for me to finish opening the door was too much for her. She has already passed the second set of doors and walking into the store when I finish closing and locking both sets. She wasn't walking to a register to clock in. She wasn't directly walking to any department. All she did was quickly look around the store before turning back to me and says,
"Where is your game section? I'm looking for a Switch."
My heart dropped. She was a customer that I let into the store before opening. Big no-no. I start to internally panic a little, but think to myself that all I need to do is get her out of the store. Me. "I'm sorry, ma'am, but we don't open for another 40 minutes. I thought you were one of my coworkers when I let you in." The crazy lady rolls her eyes and says,
"The website says that you open at 8 a.m. It is 8:20.
Me. "Our website says 9 a.m. I'm telling you 9 a.m. You need to leave."
"I only need to buy a Switch. It will be 10 minutes.
She begins to walk further into the store when I stand in her path. Me. "You can buy whatever you want at 9 a.m. But right now, you need to leave." This lady is getting mad and says,
"I want to speak to your manager right now."
Now, I was the only one working in the warehouse that morning. We are really understaffed. But there was a supervisor in the back office doing paperwork. The supervisor is a really understanding dude, so I knew he wouldn't get mad at me for letting this crazy lady in by mistake. But I made the idiot decision to deal with this myself. Me. "I am the only one here. Now leave." This is a good time to tell you all that I am a 5'3", 100-pound girl who looks like I'm 15 when I'm really in my 20s. I do not look intimidating in any way. The crazy lady got this smirk on her face and said,
"Fine, I'll go."
And when she started to walk to the doors, I think that's the end of it. Until she grabs the Xbox off of the counter and tries to unlock the doors. I rushed up to her and began to tug at the Xbox while yelling at her to let go, and "I will call the police." The Xbox was wrapped in a security tag, so the whole time this tug of war was happening, the door alarms are blaring because of the tag. My supervisor hears the alarm and comes out of the back office to find me wrestling with this crazy Karen. He comes over to help, but not before the crazy lady punched me hard in the stomach. I let go of the Xbox to hold my stomach, but she still doesn't have the door unlocked. I ended up puking on her and the Xbox. She drops the Xbox and goes to hit me again, but I saw this one coming and mustered up all my strength and rage to kick her square in the chest. I might not look strong, but I can do darn well be when needed. But I only had the strength for that one kick. I rolled into a ball and agonized over the pain afterwards. My supervisor called the police while the woman whined in pain and was still trying to unlock the door. I guess she didn't realize that keys are used to open doors. Next we've got, customer has a meltdown over $10. Finally, a full-scale crazy Nova at my till. Buckle up, buckaroos. I work at an international supermarket chain that allows staff to sit at tills. I was having a pretty swell day. Nearly every customer had been a friendly regular, so all is cruisy. Until I spot an older woman who's trying really hard to look younger, unloading her trolley onto my tread. She brings the trolley up, but leaves some produce in it. I ask her if they were from our store. She doesn't answer. Instead, she pushes back past some customers in line to grab more bags. I just start pulling out the produce and scanning it. I could tell it was ours, but wanted to give her a chance to get it herself. I scan in all her groceries quietly. Things are chill, and it comes to $149.07. I read the total and ask her, "Cash or card?" She doesn't answer again, and just continues to slowly put the items in one at a time. I assume she didn't hear, and wait until she finishes. I read the total again, and finally get an answer of card. I enable the machine, and she sticks her card in. She then asks what the total is. Keep in mind, it's displayed on the machine. I repeat the total a third time for her, still cheery and smiling. Her card declines. Cool, no issue. She asks if she can pay some with cash and then the rest on card. Oh, of course, no worries, I say as I accept the cash off her. She says it's $50 just as I'm putting it in, but I still have half of it in hand and I remembered exactly what she gave. 120, 110, and 2 fives. A little dreadnought forms as I knew she wouldn't take the facts of basic math well. I start to explain what she's actually given me, but she cuts me off and instantly gets aggressive while repeating,
"It's $50. I gave you $50. That's 50.
I learned from this sub about quick change artists, and I also didn't want my tail to be out, least of all for someone like this. I start to get the adrenaline shakes. I hate this as it makes my voice quiver, even though I'm not scared of this woman in the slightest. I don't want her to hear my voice shake and think it's an opening to attack, so I quickly but politely tell her, "I'll have to quickly go and count my till. That way I know exactly what it is. I'll call a manager up so we can suspend this in the meantime." While waiting for a manager, she doesn't take long to go from frustrated to full-blown Karen.
"Go ahead, I can wait. I've got all day."
I know she's trying to use the waiting cue to pressure me. I just smile and say, "No worries." She gets madder.
"Yeah, I can stand here all day, rather than just sitting down. I can pull up a chair too. How about you offer me a seat too, huh?"
I'm dumbfounded, but keeping my face neutral. The line is long and full of regulars who love me. None of the other tills have chairs, so I smile, stand, and say, "Not a problem, ma'am. Please, feel free to have my chair." I awkwardly push my office chair out of the register cube and directly towards her. She sits down without a thank you, while everyone in line judges her harshly. I know they're all on my side if I need a witness to vouch. A manager finally arrives, suspends the customer's sale, and jumps in for me while I go to count. I'm not even to the office door 10 meters away when I hear her screaming at him for moving her trolley aside so he can serve others. She starts yelling,
"Don't you touch my trolley! I just want to buy my groceries."
She points over at me.
"I already gave that girl $50, and she accused me of shortchanging her. The liar. I would never."
I and the manager make eye contact, and I try to give him a look that says, "No, I definitely didn't," and left to count up. While counting, I could hear her screaming through the thick brick walls. I couldn't make out words, but she was consistently going for it. With our money weighing machine, it only took me a few minutes to count, and it turned out I was right. She only gave me $40. I head back out, and she's practically out the doors, attempting to leave with her full trolley. The manager who jumped in for me has left the till and is refusing to let go of her trolley, and she's screaming right in his face,
"I already gave the girl $50. Give me my shopping."
Then suddenly, like an angel, our head manager arrives out of nowhere, just in time. He mellowed her out by telling her she had two choices. Either come back in and pay, or he'll call the cops and file a report. She gapes and says,
"Of course I want to pay."
"Sure you did." I gave the head manager the details and quickly went back to work, not wanting to be dragged into her maw of spite. The manager ended up just giving her the $10 to get rid of her, but also got her to pay for her groceries. He basically said to us later that if she shows up again, to buzz him immediately so he can boot her out. P.S. The customers who had all been waiting and dealing with her tantrum overheard that she only gave me 40, so they all laughed even harder at her when she left. Next we've got,
"This is unacceptable. I know you work here."
I am a 6'3" male, a little on the chubby side, 350 pounds, but I do not look it. I work at a place that is a sister company that rhymes with tall blard. We wear very similar colored vests, but as you might have guessed, with different logos. I was also wearing black shorts, a silver hat, with a nice dark blue polo shirt. For this story, we've got me, we've got Wicked Karen of the West, we've got manager and employee. One fateful night, as I'm just getting off of work about 9:30 p.m., my girlfriend calls me to tell me that we are out of milk and some other miscellaneous items, but I only remember leaving with the milk. As I pull into a parking spot and get out of my vehicle, I hear a faint,
Excuse me, sir.
Not thinking it was pointed in my direction. I thought nothing of it. Mistake number one. Halfway towards the entrance door, I realized that I didn't take off my vest from work. Mistake number two. So I quickly turn around and put the vest in my truck. This time, hearing a more noticeable, more agitated,
"Excuse me, sir."
Once again, I thought nothing of it. Mistake number three. And entered the store. Fast forward about 10 minutes, with the milk in my hand, standing by the flower wall, trying to decide on buying my girlfriend some roses or not before I head out. I would do anything for that woman. I feel a sharp pain in my side and left leg. Cue Wicked Karen. I stumbled sideways and almost fell over. Someone rammed me with their cart intentionally. I turned to the person, very upset at this moment. Really quickly, I am a very non-confrontational person and try to avoid any sort of confrontation if possible, and yell,
"What the?"
But before I could say another word, she, like most Karens, cuts me off. This lady had the trademark Karen hairdo, long acrylic nails, a designer purse, looked to be in her mid to late 40s, and looked to be about 5'5". Karen.
I can't believe how incredibly disrespectful and rude you are. I am a paying customer. I called for you to come help me in the parking lot, and you, as an employee, ignored me. Don't you know who I am? I will have your job for this. Come with me, you piece of crap. We're going to talk with your manager.
She then went to grab my arm to try to drag me to the nearest manager. Watching a 5'5" lady try to drag a 6'3" full-grown man like he's a little kid will always make me laugh. But like I said, I was upset. I snatched my arm away from her and yelled back,
"Lady, I don't give a flying rat who you think you are, and honestly, I don't want to know. I do not work here. Also, what gives you the right to physically grab someone when you don't get what you want, you entitled jerk?"
Upon hearing the yelling, I heard some running footsteps, and around a corner popped out an employee. Employee.
"What's going on here?"
Karen. Insert smug smiles here.
"This employee ignored me and assaulted me when I tried to ask for help. I demand to speak with your manager about getting this man fired."
Me.
"Lady, that's a lie and you know it. You're the one grabbing people. I never laid a hand on you. And personally, I don't want to, you grunt. I don't work here."
Employee runs to get the manager.
"How dare you talk to me like that? Do you kiss your mother with that disgusting mouth of yours?"
"Not that it's any of your business. As a matter of fact, I do, and she loves me very much. Can't say the same about you, though. Not with your attitude."
Karen, insert wicked banshee scream here.
"Do you know who I am? I will personally make sure you never work in this town again."
Lady, I thought I already summarized that I do not care who the heck you are, nor do I want to. You're lucky that I haven't already called the police on you. At this moment, employee and manager come running around the corner. Manager.
"What seems to be the problem here?"
Karen.
"I was minding my own business when your employee grabbed me and started yelling and berating me. I want this man fired."
Me. "What the heck, lady? More lies. How many times do I have to say it to get it into your entitled thick skull?
Read my lips, lady. I do not work here."
Me to the manager.
"Sir, she is spreading lies and twisting her story around. She's the one that grabbed me."
I lifted my shirt to show him the marks that were left by her cart on my side.
"Ew, no one wants to see your fat body. Put it away, now. OMG, who would love something like that?"
Yes, she went there. I will be proud of what I said next till the day I die. Once again, I have no idea who this woman is or if she has a daughter or not, but what I said shut her up. Me.
"That's not what your daughter said last night."
Employee.
"Oh!"
Manager to employee.
"Stop it!"
Manager tells me.
"Sir, I'm going to have to ask you to stop right there before I escort you out of the building."
Me. "Sorry, I understand." Manager tells Karen.
"Ma'am, I can assure you that this man does not work here."
"This is unacceptable. I know he worked here. I saw your employee get out of his truck with a blue vest on. I want him fired now."
Manager.
"Ma'am, once again, he does not work here. I haven't seen him here before."
"Just to let you know,
I will be contacting your corporate office to let them know about this rude employee that you are defending, and what an incompetent manager you are.
Manager, please leave the store, ma'am. Karen scoffs and stomps out of the store. Manager tells me, I do apologize for any inconvenience this must have caused you. Would you like us to call the police so you can file a report against her? To be honest, I seriously did consider pressing charges on her. I was tired and wanted to go home. That, and I didn't want to go through the whole court process, so I let it go, paid for my milk, and went home. That wasn't my first Karen encounter, and unfortunately, probably won't be my last either. I sincerely hope that I never run into that woman again. Thank you for reading.
So, Karen, what did you think of today's stories?
They were horrible.
Horrible? How dare you? These were some of the best we've ever read.
Oh, shut up, Mr. Reddit. It's ridiculous what people like myself have to go through. Dealing with stupid people like yourself and your subscribers.
Look, Karen, you can say whatever you want about me, but don't you talk about my re-army.
Tch, re-army. Most of your viewers aren't even subscribed to your channel. 70% if I'm correct.
Well, I can't argue with that. That's true. Most of my viewers don't actually subscribe for some reason.
It's because you're stupid, Mr. Reddit.
No, I'm not. Alright guys, let's prove Karen wrong by making sure you're subscribed to the channel and turn on notifications.
Pah, they're not going to listen to you.
And if you'd like me, or Karen,
what?
To record a special message for you, come visit me on Fiverr, link pinned in the comments below.
Never!
And join as a channel member today, and Karen will give you a special shoutout in the next video.
Like heck I will!
And shoutouts to our regenerals of the day. Oscar, Mia, and Ashley.